The B is for bollocks.
Remote control flashed from my hand, smashed the TV, burned the stand. Piss all on the DVD, you can't take the cast from me. Listen to the dog that's black, whose tinted specs are coming back. There ain't no shit that we won't see, you can't take this cast from me. There ain't no place I'd rather be, recording on Audacity. But you can't take this cast from me.
Hello and welcome to the Black Dog number 202.
202.
Which I'm just calling Truffle Shuffle for the moment.
Okay. There's bound to be something that comes along in a bit of feedback or,
yeah, you know. Maybe.
Maybe one of Elton's inspirational
conspiracy theories.
Yeah, conspiracy theories.
Yes. Anyway, I'm Lee.
I'm Darren.
I'm Elton.
And this week we're joined by Laura.
Hello.
There you go. Hello, Laura.
Hello.
She will be taking the place of Jim, who is still gun running in the Algarve.
Hello.
Yeah. Hello there, folks.
Sorry, which part of the country did you come from again? Is it down there in Devon?
Yeah.
Is that a Jim Moon in Devon now?
every county has a Jim Moon.
Yeah, they do, actually.
It's like Green Lanterns. I'm the Jim Moon of South Downs. Anyway.
They've each got a green ring.
No. Anyway, so, yes. Welcome to episode 202. We're going to have a bit of chat, maybe not news, because
it's still Harrison Ford's leg.
It's still broken.
It's still broken. I checked. It's still broken.
Yeah, there's nothing else going on. Yeah. And, and 25th anniversary Batman. Hooray. There you go. Move on. And then we've got shitty superheroes, and we've got profanasaurus, and then we're on to Goonies.
Woohoo!
Otherwise known as deep psychological trauma. But anyway. Right, so before we get on to that, let's have a go round and let's see how everyone's week's been. So, we'll start off with our guest.
Thank you.
Oh, ladies first and all that. So, Laura, how's your week?
Very good, actually. I have actual news.
Do you?
Well, kind of. I went to Ascot on Friday.
Did you?
Got to wave at the Queen.
Oh, yes. Did she wave back?
She did, but I don't think it was just at me. And
she gave you the finger.
She yes. And got immensely sunburnt. So
nice.
That was fun.
Yes.
But no, a very enjoyable day. Not normally my cup of tea, but it's very hard not to get involved when everyone's screaming and shouting at the horses.
Did you have one of those big hats? Did you invest in a big hat?
No, I'm not that rich.
Oh.
No, I had a fascinator on.
Oh, really?
Was
that just Darren dancing around in a thong behind you?
Yeah.
I don't know what he's doing.
That's not quite the word I would have said.
I don't know what he's doing, but it's fascinating. Do the dance of shame.
Although there were people walking around with flower pots on their head, and I thought it was someone's funny hat at first, but it wasn't some kind of performance type, entertainment type.
Wasn't a Devo reunion concert then, no? Crack that whip.
Nice. Okay.
Yeah, very, very good week.
Lovely.
Yes.
Anything else?
Not really, no.
Okay. Well, there you go. Well, there you go. And that's how it should be done from here on in. Everyone just say your week's good and we'll move on.
Yeah.
we'll be home in time for tea.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Well, then moving on. Elton, how was your week?
Hello.
It was good. I haven't done much apart from work and watching Breaking Bad.
Oh,
I'm not going to give anything away. I'm still addicted to it.
You're crack addicted to it.
I'm on season 4 now. I think last week I was on season 3.
last week you just finished season 2, I thought.
Oh, I had, yeah. Yes, season 4 now.
Nice. So next week you'll be on season 5 and finished.
Yes, I should have finished it in about 2 weeks' time.
Nice. Lovely.
It's brilliant. I don't. Has anyone seen the whole thing yet?
No, only seen season one.
I've seen season one. I got into season two, and then one thing led to another, and basically I couldn't go near the telly or games or anything, just because work. So
you sent to your room.
Yeah, no. I mean, it's a case of, like, even if I start watching Game of Thrones, I get into it and I need to watch all of them. Mm. And at the moment, I can't afford that time. This is my free time right here. You're listening to it right now.
Right.
This is all I have.
I feel like the way I'm watching it at the moment, I'm enjoying it a lot more than what I would have been if I'd been watching it week to week.
Yeah.
And so I think I might do TV like this from now on.
That's it. Don't buy a TV license anymore. Just buy a TV. Yeah. Take the aerial off and just plug it straight into the internet.
Exactly, yes.
Nice. Way to do it, mate.
I think it works a lot better. Because when I caught up with Game of Thrones, I've really, really enjoyed it up until midway through season four when I had to wait each week. And then it got a bit tiresome and I think I've fallen out of love with it a little bit.
Oh, never mind. I did that with Babylon 5 when Darren dropped like a sack full of videotapes.
Right, I dropped my, I did empty the content of my sack all over his floor.
He emptied his sack all over my floor and told me to take care of it until the end of summer.
Yeah.
And yeah.
I went, have it. I said, yeah. You love it.
And
I
did, mop it up.
Exactly. Yeah, mop it up. And I did 3 years of it in like the space of a week.
There you go.
And then I did that. And then I caught up with Channel 4 and it just started season 4 and it was like pulling teeth going from episode to episode to episode.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I found it more sort of, you know, don't end it there.
Yeah. No, you motherfuckers, keep playing.
Keep playing. I want to say a little bit more.
I'm getting to the point where I may actually not watch the last episode of Breaking Bad because then it never ends for me. It's just never ended.
But isn't the nature of his affliction
give anything away.
What?
Shush.
Well, that's in the first bloody episode.
Don't give anything away.
Well, you see...
If it was, we missed it. Shush.
What's the premise of the whole film? The whole season? What is it all about? It even says so on a Netflix description.
It's about a man making a lot of very fucking bad decisions that he could have easily avoided had he thought about it a bit more and not been so fucking...
stupid.
Yeah. Proud. No, proud. That's it, yeah. There's a lot of pride coming before this fall. There really is, but... Yeah, that's the way I see it anyway. Okay. Other bits that, you know, that make him make up his character.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
You know, that's part of it, but
Silly man.
Anyway, that was my week.
Okay, so brilliant. Okie dokie. Darren, how was your week?
Well, again, like Elton, I haven't really been out doing much, but very much like Elton, watching stuff, okay? Or should I say watching Archer? Okay, yeah. I mean, really watching Archer.
Yeah.
I was, last week when we spoke, I just finished season one, or I was coming up to the end of season one. I am now just about ready to go for season four. I've got two episodes left of season three. I'm doing about five or six episodes a day now.
Yeah.
Right? It's my addiction to this has grown. I'm watching it on the train to work. I'm watching it in my lunch breaks. I'm watching it on the way home.
Darren!
Exactly.
Lana!
So hardcore. He's doing three episodes a day.
Sorry, I was just doing a gesture that did not work on a podcast, but there you go. Yeah.
All I'll say is bum shock fight. I'm not saying anymore. But no, the show just keeps getting better and better. It really does. It's just.
I don't know what you're talking about, but it looks highly amusing.
You wait till later on. The characters have just come on leaps and bounds. I mean, they were good to start with, but so much. You learn so much about them, and it's just kind of like, what the fuck? Every time you learn a new thing, that's the phrase that accompanies it, is what the fuck?
Yeah, Pam.
Pam.
The HR.
It's just. That's probably the most shocking. I would say Pam is the most shocking character in it. Because what you learn about her as she goes
on. What she's willing to do and put up with.
Exactly. But nope, saying anymore.
Fine.
So,
anything else? No. Moving on swiftly.
Moving on swiftly. So, no, apart from that, that's it, basically. It's been me all the time. Just.
Ooh, bah. We did find out something interesting on Saturday night, though, didn't we?
We did.
Your tests are clear.
Remind me.
Go on.
A friend of a friend of a friend lives next door to...
Mr. Jolly.
What is it? It does, doesn't it? Oh, no, no, not him. No, oh. No, the other one. Make it so.
No, lives next door to Patrick Stewart.
Lives next door to Patrick Stewart. Make it so.
Yeah. Nice.
Would you like a tea? Would you like a drink? Gin and tonic. Make it so. Yeah. You've never seen Star Trek. you live at home with your mum and you've never seen Star Trek.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, oh, my God.
You're in your 30s. Oh, cool.
So
we were trying to wrangle our way into a house party so that we could meet him.
Oh.
It didn't quite work. Ah. That would have been on Sunday night, though.
Yeah, so it could have been a
do
really...
Do it. How gate crash.
We just thought Mel Smith moment, you know, we have to bring that back.
Yeah, man.
If it was Patrick Stewart.
Or when you're finally climbing the fences next door.
As you're falling into the barbecue and Patrick Stewart's going, put that man out, he's on fire.
Right, we're here for the party. Walk straight through the house and straight into the back garden, over the fence. This is where we want to be.
Cool. So you haven't got to meet him or anything, though?
No.
It's the long game, apparently. Our friend who knows this person, because he lives next door to him.
We'll get here one day.
Yeah, exactly. One day we'll get there.
Nice.
Yeah.
And who knows? You know, McKellen might show up as well.
Mm. Yeah, we're bestest buddies.
And then there was bare-knuckle fighting and everything. That was it.
We're having a good time, Charles, not them. Let's go bum fighting. Anyway, cool. Okie dokie. Well, I've been filming. That's my big thing this week. My small thing to get out of the way is that I, if you notice that I'm playing with my hand a lot, that's because I hooked my gold ring, my grandfather's
oh,
service
right.
ring.
I did wonder there for a moment.
I hooked it on Carol's watch and she yanked it and basically snapped the gold ring actually off me. And it used my finger to do it. So
God, she's unfeasibly strong.
Yes, and well, it's a 70-year-old gold ring, so chances are it's probably a bit weak. But the thing is, nevertheless, it has severely damaged and bruised my knuckle on my ring finger. So if you notice I'm kind of holding it, that's because I'm in severe...
You're holding it together.
That's because I'm in severe pain.
But this is no fun. You didn't do this yourself. You know,
no,
it wasn't self-inflicted.
No.
You weren't trying to chop a tree down with a chainsaw while balancing on a tea tray that's on a fucking cricket ball or something like that. You know,
while
wearing swimming trunks or something. You know,
on my head,
on your head. Yeah.
No. It was basically because we dog walk a dog called Max every Tuesday afternoon, and basically he doesn't like other dogs, so he jumped up to get this dog. I tried to grab him.
Yeah.
Carol went down to grab him as well, and I didn't know that the service ring, my granddad's service ring, got hooked on her watch. She pulled her hand away and it literally went tink and took it straight off my finger.
Christ.
So yeah, I'm in a bit of pain, to say the least. I don't know what I've done actually physically damaged inside. It doesn't seem too bad. It's kind of swelling. You can see where my ring was, so to speak.
There's swelling around the ring.
There is swelling around the ring.
Unusual, you know.
There is severe bruising of the ring.
I'm so glad this isn't a video call.
The ring, the ring has snapped. But anyway...
My wife snapped my ring.
Yeah, my wife. Yeah, snapped my ring. It was my turn this week. Not anniversary this year.
Yep.
Right. Anyway. So. But I was in, around, and above, and beyond, and inside, and on top of, and everywhere around Battersea, on the weekend, filming for the BBC as my new role as visual effects supervisor.
Hoorah.
So, yes.
Do you have to go around in a dinner suit?
I have to. I think it's obligatory that every VFX supervisor has to wear a hoodie and look like they haven't slept for 6 months. So I was already ahead of the curve.
Excellent.
But it was really funny because it was essentially my job was to take all the details and all the information of what was going on with all the camera work that has anything to relate to visual effects.
Yeah.
But that means getting in the way of the cameraman, the assistant cameraman, the director of photography, the director, the producer, everyone, and just jump in front of them and go, stop, I must take a photograph of this colour lens, and I must take a look at this lens grid, and I must get all the lens information off this camera, and don't move it, don't move it. No, don't go and set it up. I have to write all this stuff down. And, yeah, so I was well popular after about 10 minutes because I was kind of adding like 3 minutes to every shot by me going, no, don't film it from this angle because you can see the shadows. It's nothing like the one over there. Continuity. Oh, no. Anyway, so it turns out they all hated me by about Friday afternoon. And then I explained to them exactly how much I was going to save them in money.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden I became their bestest friend and they took all the time in the world.
I bet.
Yeah. So,
how much are you saving them in money? You're allowed to say
thousands and thousands and thousands,
loads.
No, because they got three effects companies working on this.
Oh, right. Okay.
And I'm sitting in between all of them, Double Negative, Framestore, and then a bunch from Escape Studios. And essentially, they're all going to be working on different aspects of this film.
So it's all big names then.
Yeah, and they have to get all their information and all their live action footage information and all the project stuff has to go through me.
Wow.
Ooh. Power. Absolute power. Anyway, so that was quite funny. But then the best bit of all of it, the bit that I can talk about, is the fact that we had to do some pickup shots of Battersea Power Station from all different angles.
Mm-hmm.
But long and the short of it is the whole thing was being filmed this weekend in a rush because Battersea Power Station is about to be covered in tarpaulin and they're about to take the chimneys down.
Are they?
No.
Yeah, they're going to put them back up.
Oh, right, okay.
But essentially, they're going to be building flats inside Battersea Power Station and use the outside as a sort of shell around the flat. And there's going to be a cinema in there, and there's going to be an IMAX cinema in there, and there's going to be a TV studio. There's going to be all sorts of stuff in there. It's costing about 8 billion quid, and it's going to take like 9-10 years. But because it's just a shell and these big sort of chimneys are just sort of sitting on top, they're really unstable. So if you start building inside, they're going to fall over. So what they're doing is going to cover it all in tarpaulin, shore it all up, take those chimneys down, build everything inside, and then put them back on.
So if they do that and they change the outside, oh no, the whole post-apocalyptic film industry for London is going to go down the drain hole because where are they going to film?
You know? Yes, well, exactly. I tell you, the inside of it did look like a sort of set from fucking Fallout or something like that. It really did look pretty, you know, bombed out. But the thing was, because of all of this, this weekend is like the last weekend before they all the sort of scaffolding and the tarpaulin starts going up. So the real filming for this film I'm on doesn't start until sort of mid-September, October.
Right.
By which time, Battersea Power Station, the finale of the film, will essentially be covered from head to foot in white tent. So, and will not have any chimneys. So they had to do it this weekend. That meant they didn't have time to get all the permits for filming all around London at various angles of Battersea Power Station. They only had time to get on to Battersea Power Station, which we could do, and we had all the rights to do that. But filming it from Chelsea Bridge? No, we didn't have rights to do that. Filming from the other side of the embankment? No, we didn't have rights to do that either. Filming from here, there, and everywhere? No. So it got to the point where we were actually driving around in three cars with a ton of cinema equipment.
We haven't got a license. Run!
Exactly. And we were literally jumping out. One guy was sort of like sitting in the car waiting for us to go. And we'd jump out. He'd drive around the block. We'd set everything up. And then if we saw a policeman or anyone of an authority, we'd kind of like wrap it up and run around the corner with all this kit. And like the Ariflex camera that we were carrying. Luckily, I had nothing to do with this thing, but this camera cost about £750,000.
Christ.
And then the lens weighed like fucking 5 kilos or something stupid. Like, it was massive, great big lenses. And so there's all these big burly guys running around with like big fucking cases and like, go, 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 go. But it got finally out of hand when we found a really good shot. We were up on a hill, just up on the north bank, and we went up this hill. And the director went, oh, that's a fucking great shot of the station. We really are going to get that because it's like the bombed outside where they're kind of pulling down one wall. And then also, there's no buildings in the way. because there's this loads of just rail tracks which we can film straight over the top of. So it's like, brilliant. Pull up, all jump out, set everything up. Ta-da! Then all of a sudden, it's like, as we're filming it, they're all going, shoot, shoot, shoot. And I'm going, no, I've got to take lens of details and blah, blah, and everyone's getting really nervous. And I'm thinking, why are they getting more nervous now than when we were filming like on Chelsea Bridge and, you know, Albert Bridge and all these things? Suddenly it turned out we'd actually snuck in, well, I say snuck in, we walked through a door in a wall that led to the shot that we could see. But the wall was surrounding the British Rail Transport Police Station.
Oh.
So we were actually inside. We'd snuck into a police station to film over a wall. And everyone was shitting because basically you're not supposed to be there. And we'd got in via sort of like, we'd got in via like the railway. So it's like, no. We're not definitely not being there. And no. Every now and again, like the runner who had a terrible sense of humour, but we kept going up and going, policeman! And everyone would be like, scrabbling, bolts going up in the air, clapperboards flying, everyone running. And then I'll be like, nah, just joking. By the end of it, I think they nearly threw him in the river. But
did you get the shot?
We did get the shot. Ozzy did go on stage with his brown M&Ms. Yeah, excellent. No, it was great. It was good. It was really good. And it was tremendous fun. The whole weekend was really good fun.
The way you mentioned the whole filming there, like, you know, getting the sneaky shots in, that is how they used to film the Sweeney.
Yeah.
On the outside with the car chases and everything. They used to have a fucking license for that either.
Yeah, well, the thing is, sometimes it's better to ask for forgiveness than ask for permission.
Mm.
As Mr. Palastides informed me yesterday. But so that was good. And then on Sunday we did actually film inside the power station, went right inside and went round the area where they filmed Aliens and bits where they filmed like bits of Dark Knight.
Wow.
You know the scene where Harvey Dent has got Commissioner Gordon's kids?
Yeah.
And then Batman basically knocks him to the ground, knocks him off. And
that was Battersea Power Station.
That was Battersea Power Station. And I actually stood on that area where he got knocked off.
Did you jump?
No, because how fucking far it is. No wonder he died. It must have been about 30 feet.
Really?
It's fucking huge. I mean, it's not like when you look at it in the shot. I mean, when you see it and it's like, oh, he must have fallen about like 5 feet. No, he felt like a bus length all the way down.
Ow.
Yeah, it would have hurt. So anyway, it was great. It's good fun. And we got to play with big drone cams, going buzzing through the air. Then we went to a £2.5 million show home that they were building in there.
I saw the pictures on Facebook, actually. Mm.
What you didn't see was the funky £100,000 relaxing on the patio seats, which look like spinning tops.
Really?
And you literally sit in them and they kind of roll around like you're sort of sitting inside a ping pong ball. And yet you rest and they kind of find your centre of gravity. And it's like, whoa, I could get used to this.
Mm-hmm. Was the actual showroom in Battersea Station?
Yeah, you can still see it. If you look at Battersea Power Station, if you look at it, the side that's away from the river, so not the side that's actually facing the river, but if you go to the opposite side, and if as you're looking at it from the river, it's the furthest corner away from it on the right, and it's actually like perched on top like a little glass box.
Cool. Ooh.
And yeah, £2.5 million it was, and yeah, that's not even the biggest one. The penthouse one that's going to be underneath like the chimneys is going to be £4 to £5 million, and the smallest one, the one bedroom basement flat. Yeah, he's going for about £1.5 million.
Christ.
I'd like to see them making the affordable housing they promised us.
Yeah, it's lovely, yeah. Mm. So, but no, you go in there, it's all open plan. You go straight from the bedroom into the living room, straight from the living room into the kitchen, then onto this massive patio that's overlooking the whole of London. It's just like, oh yeah, I could get used to that. And the whole house is wired up to like this iPad. So you can turn your lights on, you can turn the TV on, you can turn the music on, all the music's wired up, all the floors heated. Oh, fucking, the whole thing was just like, wow. Oh, I could do me some of that.
Mm.
And then I spilt Coke on the floor. Anyway, everyone freaked. But anyway, So there you go, yeah. But yeah, we even had some making of sort of footage filmed by the drone cam while we were up there.
Do you know?
We all had to stand there and pretend we were working. We all just stand there and point at things and get a clapperboard out and write on it and just stand there.
Very serious with your hands on your shoulder.
Mm. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, the director had to sort of rest on the camera while I was sort of standing there with a clipboard going, look at this, and doing the old framing with your fingers. Oh, like, everyone was doing all that sort of shit. It was just stupid. But anyway, no, it was good fun. I'm quite looking forward to the next few months when it all kicks off properly.
Mm. When do we get the skinny on what it is that's actually going on?
When the production goes public. We're filming in September. It's like I say, mid-September, October.
Yeah.
And then the special effects kick in after that. So I'm around for all of that. So it'll be into December. So I don't think there's anything publicly going to be going on until sort of January next year. So there you go. Boring. And there you go. So that's my week. Standing very, very up. I got sunburnt as well. I got sunburnt on the news.
Yeah.
Yes, while I was standing on the roof.
I was going to say, you was wearing like the world's biggest jumper on the hottest day as well.
Yeah, well, it was overcast. The whole thing.
How'd you get sunburnt? Flip it out.
It was on my nose, man. It was like really, it went right red. I looked like Carl Malden from On the Streets of San Francisco. I had this big on my nose. And, we were filming with armed soldiers as well. That was good. They were running around with guns, proper guns. And, so they let me have a go there.
Speaking of British Transport Police and guns.
Yes.
I saw a couple of them getting off at Cannon Street Station the other day, and I was thinking, that's not normal, is it?
No. When was the other day?
It was like Thursday or Friday last week when I was waiting for my train after work.
Mm.
British Transport Police with proper AK-47.
MP4s, yeah.
Yeah, that's the ones.
Yeah.
Well, you do know that the Antiques Roadshow was actually filming in that area at that time, so, you know, they've got to keep them in check.
You know how Michael Aspel can get out of control when he's had a couple of sugars in his tea. Oh, fuck, my finger really hurts.
Yeah, don't mention Formica.
Formica! Anyway, yeah, moving swiftly over that. Should we do news, or are we going to just skip it? What do you reckon?
Is there anything to report?
I got nothing.
Naked Karen Gillan.
we all just take a moment.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then we'll move
on. And now you're done, yep.
Yeah.
Queen visited the Game of Thrones, and that was around about it.
But she didn't sit on the Iron Throne.
No.
Well, she's got a proper one. She's got a gold one. She don't need no plastic pretending to be an Iron Throne in Belfast.
Like the one at home, is it?
Yeah. Oh, it's not very comfortable. I thought I would at least put a cushion on it.
Last time I sat on something made of that much metal, I got piles up me arse.
Yeah, Prince Philip going around going, you're not entirely sure this has been made by British people. It's all a little bit foreign. As he wanders around Belfast. Anyway. And there you go. With some casual racism, I think we'll move on to shitty superheroes.
Very cool and they're not very cool. fast and then most likely die in a fight. It's shitty heroes. Just one look at these dudes and you know they ain't right. Marvel DC doesn't mean much to me because they are a total shite.
Hulk smash! Puny Lounge Singer.
Right, shitty superheroes for this week. We got two.
Two.
And they're brothers.
The double whammy.
Double whammy. They are called Mas and Menos. And they are Spanish, Latino kind of...
I know what that means.
What's that mean?
More or less.
More or less. There you go. Well done. Well done. Doesn't relate to them, though.
No.
Anyway, so they have a really good superpower. They have super speed.
Okay.
Right? Seems okay.
Not we're so all, shitty so far.
We're all on board for that, yeah?
Yep.
Cool. There's only one slight problem. They have no other superpowers, and their superpowers can only be activated if they're holding hands.
The Spanish Chuckle Brothers.
Yes, that's
you to me, me to you.
Yeah, exactly. They were in the Teen Titans. They both only speak Spanish, so none of the other Teen Titans actually understand them. And and they only have super speed as long as they're holding hands. That's it.
Right.
Otherwise, if they let go even for a second, they immediately stop. And they have just go back to being people in what looks like white running suits.
So they just run around clotheslining people.
That's essentially it, like awesome. some dodgy sort of WWE wrestler. But yes, unsurprisingly, these are one of the DC superheroes not to be rebooted into the new 52 universe.
Really?
I know, it's shocking. Yes, but Manos M. Yeminos. And they lasted for 20 issues until... they were taken down by Dr. Light and the Mirror Master. And that's it. They lasted 20 issues and they were killed.
But they will be appearing in Batman vs. Superman Dawn of Justice.
Well, yeah, exactly. I think it's going to be played by Matt Lucas twice.
Yeah, Adam Sandler. They're going to be played by Adam Sandler.
Exactly. So there you go. Yeah, 20 issues. Mas and Menos. Yeah, not really a lot I can say to that, to be frank. That's it. Anyone got anything they'd like to add?
Hang on, I'm just looking them up.
Yeah, they can run, but they can't really run unless they're holding hands.
So there that's you like go. Astro Boy.
What? Are you looking at the same thing?
Oh, maybe not.
Yeah.
Can
they
we
look,
show us
they
a
look,
picture?
Yeah.
Oh, go. One's got a plus and one's got a minus.
They look a bit like sort of like speed skaters.
Yeah, they do, yeah.
Yeah, there you go.
They're bobbins.
Yes, pretty bobbins. I tell you what I will do as well. I'll give you another one. And I'll give you this one because it came from Chris Johnson. He gave us four. And I'm not entirely sure if we've done this one before, so I'll throw this one in now.
Does it involve a cock?
No.
Because if it is, we've done the cock-based ones. We've done all
no,
those.
No, 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 no. This one.
Oh, hang on. I've just found cosplay for Mas and Menos.
Oh, shut up. What?
Oh, that's your new addition, isn't it? You know, adding the cosplay element into it. Can you find cosplay of this shitty superhero?
I just type cosplay after the title. That's it.
Okie dokie.
As long as it's not a body paint version, then we're fine.
Well, I'll tell you what. While you're looking for that, look for this one. This character, and this is one of the four supplied by Chris Johnson. His real name is Dag Wentram. He's an alien. He first appeared in the Venture Comics 306, lasted 46 issues, and he's from the planet Zven. And basically, they have a single power, which allows them to hibernate through the long nights of the planet. We can't see that, Elton. hold on. We will see that. We will see that now. Come on, Skype. Show us what you got. Oh my God, there they are. That's them. Yeah, that's
who the fuck is that in the middle?
That's the Red Arrow.
The Red Arrow, right. That's, I couldn't see properly.
Green Arrow's sort of Robin.
Right.
Nice. That's embarrassing. Very embarrassing. Yeah. But our other superhero, see if you can find cosplay for this then, Nilton.
Okay.
Yeah, he's from the planet Zven, and they have an ability to hibernate through the orbit of their planet, which takes them out of the way of the sun. That ability is that they can turn themselves into stone. So, basically, he has this tactically unimpressive power, and his name is Stone Boy. He literally... He has the ability to turn himself into stone. Unfortunately, when he is turned into stone, he is completely unable to move.
Well...
rendering himself entirely shit.
Could he jump so and then make himself into stone as he was jumping and then land on someone?
Oh, yeah, no. The other thing is when he turns into stone, he becomes unconscious. So he essentially goes into hibernation.
So how does he get out of it?
He has to
that's
come out of hibernation.
That's just like the poor boy who turned into a fortress, isn't it?
Yeah, that's Fortress Boy.
He got banged on the noggin.
Yeah, he got hit on the head and couldn't remember that he wasn't a fortress, though. Yes. That was his problem.
I'm a bear at home. Yeah.
Hello, I'm your computer. I'm your bedroom, and I can see what you're doing, you dirty, dirty bird. Yeah, so... yeah, that's it. Yeah, there's Stone Boy. Yeah.
Stone Boy. Terrible.
It is. 64 issues he lasted.
Wow, that must be the first person who actually, you know, is only any good if he does fall asleep on the job.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so, but the thing is, yeah, throughout, on most of his missions, Stone Boy could only transform into an inanimate stone statue and was often used in numerous ways, such as being dropped on a villain from above by his teammates, or at best being used as a distraction while his other teammates carried out another mission. So they just like prop him up against the door or sort of wave him over a fence or something and then fuck off and do something else.
To get over something really high.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So there you go, Stone Boy. A third shitty superhero for this evening. And yes, if like Chris, you have found some terrible, terrible superheroes, please send them in to Blackdog at Geek Planet Online and I will inflict them upon the... assembled masses. Yeah, and that's that. So, shall we have a Jim Moon's Profanasaurus?
Yeah, go on in.
Yes, please.
Lovely.
Goonies. Euphemism. Definition 1. 2 hours of bratty shouting inexplicably hailed as some kind of 80s masterpiece. Definition 2. Where you kick an Arsenal fan if you want to see him double up in pain and clutching his family jewels.
Thank you very much for that, Jim, and I'm sure we'll be hearing more from him in the feedback section. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's go back to the 80s and indulge in some nostalgia therapy with The Goonies. Is this a rose tinted specs or shit cover goggles?
It'd be a rose tinted specs, wouldn't it, really?
Okay.
It's just how the film's regarded. That's
All right.
It's a rose-tinted specs.
Yeah, all right.
Thanks.
All right. Bastards, my podcast.
Think back to the films you remember as good, ones you haven't viewed in a while. How the story rocked and the actors were great, the camera work had flair and style. What would happen now if you watched them today? Are they still as fresh as before? Or do they stink as bad as a piss-covered tramp and leave you screaming on the floor? You know it can be real sad to find that special film is bad. Wish you just left it a pleasant memory. Now it's time for rose tinted specs on Black Domo. Watching movies from the past you thought were great. Yes, it's time for rose tinted specs on Black Domo. Send your feedback in and tell us how they rate.
Right, Goonies. Goonie, goonie, yum, yum, and all that. Right, so, directed by Richard Donner, produced by Richard Donner, and screenplay by Chris Columbus.
Starring Richard Donner.
Yeah, exactly. Made by a Donner kebab. Anyway, story by Steven Spielberg. Starring Sean Astin, Josh Brolin, Jeff Cohen, Corey Feldman, Kerry Green, Martha Plimpton, and Kei Hei Kwan. Sorry, I was just really glad I managed to get through that without sounding like I was some sort of mad racist like Mickey Rooney in, sort of in Breakfast at Tiffany's. Anyway, released June 7th, 1985, and it was made for $19 million, and the box office it raked in was $61 million. The production started on October the 22nd, 1984, and lasted 5 months. There was an additional 6 weeks of ADR recording, blah, 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 blah. Shooting script was lengthy and over 120 pages initially. There was also a mention of an octopus at the end. This seems like an exaggeration, but actually it was a scene that was filmed and was cut out. So, yes, the whole octopus thing, don't know why that they didn't cut that bit out. In the making of The Goonies, director Richard Donner noted the difficulties and pleasures of working with so many child actors. Donner praised them for their energy and excitement, but says that they were a handful when brought together. The documentary frequently shows him coaching young actors, revealing some techniques that he used to get some realistic performances. And one of these tricks involved the One-Eyed Willy ship, which actually was an impressive full-size mock-up of the ship created under the direction and production designer J. Michael Rivier. Donner restricted the child actors from actually seeing the ship until they filmed the scene where it was seen. The character's first glimpse of the ship was thus basically the actor's first view of it, bringing out a more realistic performance. However, Corey Feldman, having seen the film, seen the build beforehand, says that in that particular scene he basically had to kind of act, whereas everyone else was overwhelmed at seeing it.
Bit of a stretch for him, I know.
But he was a bit of a stretch, yeah. In his book There and Back Again, Sean Austin, hello, Mr. Frodo, claims that Richard Donner and Steven Spielberg were like conductors on set as he compares and contrasts their styles when directing certain scenes. Some of the on-location filming was done in Astoria, Oregon, and the interiors were of the old Catsop County Jail features as some of the place where Jake Fratelli starts the film. Building was later converted into the Oregon Film Museum. Don't care about the stages. Film critics were generally favourable towards The Goonies. Rotten Tomatoes reports that 67% of the critics gave the film a positive review. With an average of 6 out of 10, the critical consensus is that it's an energetic, sometimes noisy mix of Spielbergian sentiment and funhouse tricks that will appeal to kids and nostalgic adults alike. At Metacritic, which assigns normalized ratings out of 100, it also has a score of 60, indicating mixed to average reviews. Several reviewers noted that the film appeared to be enjoyable for kids, but not so much for adults. Goonies grossed $9 million in its opening weekend and was second in the charts behind Rambo First Blood Part 2. That's about the size of it, really. The movie has garnered the cult following over the years. Scottish actor James McAvoy has repeatedly cited in interviews that The Goonies is one of his favourite films of all time. There was a video game, and the soundtrack was only recently released. And there were proposed sequels, but and even a cartoon planned by a certain Cartoon Network, which was shelved in 2007. And that's it. In 2008, Donald had met with all the principal actors and said that there would be an irreverent script, but unfortunately, it's never seen the light of day. And that is all there is to say about The Goonies, according to Wikipedia, which is handy, because I'm not going to say much more than that without getting sweary. So, who wants to go first and tell us what you thought of Goonies?
Do you want to go first, love?
No.
You're the...
Go on.
Okay.
You have the mic.
Why don't you like it?
No.
it's like Indiana Jones, but...
For shit.
Kids. But when you were a kid, which is why I was the right age to watch this film, it was Indiana Jones for you.
Oh,
you felt you could...
No, go on.
Let us speak.
You felt you could be in it. You could be a part of it. And I've never grown out of that. So, yeah, I love it.
Okay. And there's nothing changed since last time?
Nothing's changed, but I remember having this on video when I was a kid and watching it so much that the sound went, basically.
You wiped out the sound.
But I was always convinced that one day I could watch it, I just put the sound up really, really high. But I never had the first part of the film. Because I must have just switched on the recorder when I saw it was on. And so I didn't realise that very first scene in the jail is actually really dodgy.
Yeah, with the suicide.
Hanging.
It's quite grim.
And so this family have taken their kids to see The Goonies, and then the first thing they see is this man pretending to hang himself. yeah, I thought it was a bit odd. And also the friends, I think, there were a few people in there that would not have been friends in real life at all.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, the brother had to have his brother along with him, but he was obviously a jock.
Yes.
But Martha Plimpton's character and the other girl's character was like,
Andy.
Why on earth would they hang out together? That was just little things like that, but it didn't spoil it for me at all.
Okay.
I really like it.
You really like it?
I really want to go on that slide.
Oh, which slide?
The one at the end. They go down the water slide.
Oh, what? The
and they end up in the pool of water at the end.
Yeah, right.
That's my favourite bit.
Cool. Okay. Anything else?
There probably will be something when you start
acid flashbacks.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, fine. That's allowed.
It runs in the relationship.
I was going to say, the Barnard acid flashback. Yeah.
This is it. Yeah.
Who? Okay, fair enough. Well, who wants to go next?
I'll go next.
Okay.
I'll go next.
Go on then.
Do you know what? I have to agree with that review that you were going on about earlier on about that. I mean looking at it objectively from a kid's point of view, it is a great film for kids, right? There are bits that I'll comment on in a moment that I've noticed while watching it that aren't so savory.
Willy being one of them.
No, it's not only that, it's from a kid's point of view, I can see why kids would really enjoy it. So I didn't actually see this when I was little. You see, I've come to The Goonies very late. I think I must have seen it in the 90s.
Well, you were in your mid-30s when it came out, were you?
Oh, shut your big, fat, bearded face, right?
You put him off his stroke now.
Put him off his stroke. But I can see why it would appeal to kids. It's very much a, whoa, let's go do this. Nah, yes, look at this. Ooh, this thing over here. And, ooh, look, shiny bit of paper. Just what a lot of kids enjoy watching, very young kids. What I find kind of disturbing about it is, let's just point out the fucking shithead in the group, right? The
Mouth.
One played by Corey Him, right? What a fucking shit. That bloke, right? I'm sure he, later on in life, he got a few people to commit suicide on fucking Facebook, right? That's the sort of evil little shithead he is, right? He humiliates his friend right before letting him into the gate, right? Gets him to doing that fucking dance thing.
Yes.
It's like, yeah.
Truffle shuffle.
The truffle fucking shuffle, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Lighting up.
I'm sure it would be a lot of fun, but it's just, I don't know. It just seemed a bit kind of, I can see where his path in life is going. That's it,
yeah,
you know.
Gay porn and being kicked to the curb.
No, I'm talking about Mouth. Or are you talking about him?
Yeah, I'm talking about him.
Yeah. Well, I don't know where that's come from, but okay, yeah. You know.
No, it's just he reminded me of, I don't know if you remember, was it a film called Fright Night?
Yeah.
There was a guy called Evil Ed, who was kind of like a bit like Mouth, but was friends with the lead character. Yeah, yeah, well, the main actor went on to basically gay porn. that's right. Why I was kind of...
But no, he's a fucking...
Obscure.
He's a fucking bully in training, that kid.
Yeah.
He really is. He's just like... He's a cunt. He is just a cunt.
Anyway.
Yeah, at that point where he is bullying him, all these friends are turning around saying, oh, come on, you know, don't do that. And he's insisting on him doing the truffle shuffle.
Yeah.
As
if they've seen it far too many times already, but he still gets a kick out of it.
Yeah, but nobody else is. It's kind of like, you know, this is the awkward moment now. Everybody's like...
Oh, what about sticking your tongue through a perhaps priceless painting?
Well, hopefully he'll catch some kind of disease later on and get, you know, sores and shit all around his mouth. Yeah. But maybe his lips will fall off.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. Your dad's in financial dire straits as it is. Oh, there's the family heirlooms up there. That's probably worth thousands, if not millions.
No, they're from a museum. That's what's even more dodgy. Yeah,
even better. And then he just sticks
He's stolen it all.
God's sakes. That's even worse.
Stereotypes.
Oh,
as
yes.
Well.
$50 bill.
Yeah.
Yeah. I make a booby trap. Booby trap. Oh, be so sorry. Fucking hell.
Yeah, you could just see, you know, I'd see the spirit of Benny Hill standing there with those glasses on and the slick back
but
hair.
Can people of that race play a stereotype that they're just being...
There is
that was his first film. He really talked like that.
No, it was his second. He'd been in Temple of Doom.
I don't know. Did he actually? I mean, was he? You know, the actual actor himself, the actual kid. I mean, was he born in America or was he born in?
I don't know. I couldn't be asked to look it up.
No,
but I mean,
I was born in Vietnam.
He was born in Vietnam. Oh, okay, then fine. He's got an accent, but I think it was a bit accentuated.
Yes,
it was a little overdone.
The script. Pushed
really?
For it as well.
I thought he was genuinely that he was trying his best to speak English.
No, because that was the whole thing. Every time they asked him to do something, or he said he was going to do something, they ended up either sticking subtitles on the screen, or or they go the other way and go, I'm going to say booby traps, booby traps. Yeah, that's what I say, booby traps. It's like that's been written down.
Yeah,
that's not acting, is it? That's not improv. that's like, so yeah, okay, so there's like, yeah, Mr. Racist on the fucking typewriter.
Yeah.
But that's all the way through the movie though.
Yeah, exactly.
No, but that's with other characters as well.
Yeah, oh, you're fat. Yeah. Oh, you're still hungry.
Yeah, that as well. I noticed that. It's like, oh, let's see, the slightly overweight kid there is obviously hungry all the time.
Yeah, he was like,
that's what happens when you're slightly overweight, you know,
he was
you're
like
hungry all
fucking
the time.
Pac-Man.
But they still do that joke, you know, that's what I said, that joke throughout the movie.
Yeah.
Mm.
Sean Austin does it, or gets it done to him. Even his mum gets it done to him by...
So what he's saying is it's not just the foreign character that gets told it, everyone else does.
Yeah, but he's
when
the only...
When they get something wrong.
Yeah, but no, come on.
Yeah,
it's not...
it is. Josh Brolin said it to his mum.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and
he also
why don't
said
you it
listen?
To Sean Austin. No, he said she said a word and she got it wrong, and he said, "Don't you mean this?" Before he gets on the little kid's bike.
Yeah, I remember that where he's correcting the word, not the pronunciation, because the guy's going, "I'm gonna make booby traps," and he goes, "Don't you mean booby traps?" He goes, "Yes, that is what I say, booby trap." It's like, yeah, I only do eyes.
And, it's and pretty much the same thing.
I would like to sell you this little mogwai, yes.
Yeah.
Your kung fu is not strong.
So so there is that. But, and again, you know, the kid, slightly overweight, there's that, having a dig at him.
That he can smell fucking ice cream from a fucking 300 yards away.
Yeah.
In a fridge.
Mm.
Yeah. Or he'd sell up his friends for a pizza.
Yeah.
Nice.
Indeed.
Keep laying that one on thick for all the fat kids, just in case they didn't feel bad enough with the truffle shuffle at the fucking beginning.
Yeah.
No, we have to see him pouring milkshake all over himself and splitting a pizza all up the window just because he's seen a car going past.
That's all right, that scene, because it's as if he can't get close enough to that car. as he drives past.
Yeah, which is fine if it wasn't like in every other scene he's doing something like that. He's the fat, clumsy kid. Yeah, he's fat, he's clumsy. Oh, by the way, he hasn't eaten in 10 seconds, so let's make a joke about that.
Yeah, but if he hadn't have dropped that water thing, then they would never have gone on their adventure anyway. So
yeah, but they counted on it. They counted on it.
Well, there's even a bit in the attic when Sean Astin counts on him being fucking clumsy. He hands him the picture as if to say, you know what? I need to get to this bit of this map.
But I don't want to be the one to do it.
I don't want to be the one to take the fucking fall for breaking the fucking picture. Yeah. So I know what I'll do is I'll get him to break it because then my dad can kick the 7 bales of shit out of him and not me for breaking it. So there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Goonies never say die, but they say, fuck you, I'm off. That's what they say. Yeah.
There you go. You take a bullet for me.
Yeah. Fuck you, I'm away on my toes. Yeah.
Yeah, fucking right. there's one... I don't watching it a second time. There's one scene in it that didn't last as long as I thought it lasted, but in memory, it lasts for 5 minutes, and it's kind of like this is the worst kind of acting in any film, right? And it's the bit at the end where they're on the beach, and the bloke goes to the dad of Sean Astin's character, who says, "Right, you got to sign this form," and he gets out this bit of paper, and you see him going to sign it, and it's like. He's waiting for Steven Spielberg or somebody to say something about the scene. And it's like, how can I make this last long enough so it looks like I'm about to sign it, but I keep getting a migraine all of a sudden and have to rub the bridge of my nose. And I just remember that going on for fucking ever. And I'm sitting there, I remember boiling with rage watching that as it's going on and on and on. And it's like, the editing is fucking shit, this bit. Just cut this bit down.
There's whole sequences like that where they're having fights on the pirate ship and then you see all the bad guys, the Fratelli brothers, actually standing to one side, not doing anything, waiting for their cue to go.
Yeah.
There's at least three or four times.
I'm going to have to have a look at that.
Yeah. Before Sloth comes in and saves them, the kids are running around going, ah! And there's Robert Davi literally standing stage left on the screen and he's just standing there and all of a sudden it's like, then Sloth comes in and he starts moving around and waving his arms about. And it's like, you didn't think you were in the camera shot, did you? You thought they were going for a close-up on that shot because everyone's just standing there waiting for something to happen. But anyway, go on, carry on, Dale.
But, yeah, but apart from that, if you're a six-year-old and
apart
you're...
Apart from the sanitation, the roads, irrigation, public health...
What have they ever done for us? But, you know, I could... without those bits that... I mean, me as an adult's thinking... more than a six-year-old would or more than an eight-year-old would, then, you know, I can still see it how it is how kids would like this film. But from an adult's point of view, as that review said, it's like, you know, I didn't grow up with this film. I came to it late, you know. I came to it as an adult. So
In 1985.
Fuck you. Fuck you.
Go on, carry on.
Actually, no. No, actually, I would have been an adult because, yeah, well, 16. Getting there, 16, so, you know. Is that when it came out? 85?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I would have been about 16.
It might have seemed a bit childish when it came out.
16? Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, I would have been 16 in 85.
Sorry.
Yeah. 16 in 85.
Teen. Not 10.
Teen. Yeah, yeah, fuck you. Fuck you.
Sorry. Carry on.
I'm sorry, wife of mine.
Sorry.
What was that gesture you just did there?
Yeah, describe it for the podcast listeners.
I just did a peace sign.
You did do a peace sign, that's right. You were just doing peace signs. Little rabbit ears. That's all. Carry on. Elton! What did you think of this film?
I'm one of these kids that did grow up with this movie.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And with my rose-tinted specs on, I adore this movie.
Okay.
I really do adore it. And I introduced it to Kimmy about a month ago, and she now loves it.
Mm-hmm.
There you go.
And taking the rose-tinted specs off, I still like it.
Yay!
I still think it's great. The only thing that really bugs the shit out of me about this is that the kids don't stop shouting.
No.
Maybe it's because I'm a dad now and I'm surrounded by kids shouting all the time. And you think, oh, I don't want to watch a movie with more kids shouting. But that's the only real big thing that irritates me. It's the nostalgia kicks in from the very beginning because it's damp in the actual movie. And when damp. I would, yeah, it's
bad weather.
It's as if it's had a rain. It's been raining. And that's the sort of time that you would watch it because it'll be raining outside. You come in, put a movie on, it'll be Goonies. And then you go out to play and it'll still be damp, but you've had that rain there. And I think that kind of links into your psyche as a kid.
Yeah.
Lee looks most impressed.
I'm impressed. Go on, carry on.
What else did I like about it? There's lots of little bits, like the Rube Goldberg machines that they have all the way through the film. I think they're cracking.
Except it would take you 6.5 hours and about 700 yards of rope to just close the gate again.
Who cares?
Oh, shit. Someone walked through that garden gate. Shit, we're going to have to...
reset it.
Yeah, only we're have meant to work once. Yeah, otherwise, you've got to reset
gonna
have to the shock, balloon.
We're going to have to shock that chicken into laying that egg again. And how are we going to do that? You can't open the gate until these chickens had a chance to recover.
So, hold on. They're electrocuting the chicken. Do you think Mouth had something to do with that actual... Because I think he did, because it's torture. And that's what he excels at later on in life.
Yeah. Evil fuck.
Yeah.
Anyway, carry on.
I like all the call-outs to other movies as well, which are all the way through this movie.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have
Superman, Indiana Jones, Gremlins.
Yeah.
James Bond.
E.T.
James Bond.
Popeye.
Yeah.
Stand By Me as well.
Yep.
Which was after this, it was released after this movie, but it's still in there with the I think it's a cracking movie, and I can see my kids in there as well. So I think that's I still have an attachment there because I see my boy and his mates, and you know their little group, and that could be them watching that or trying to be like that. When I was younger, they're the kids that you'd want to be friends with, apart from Mouth because he was a bit of a dick. But yeah, you know, I think he kind of redeems himself towards the end of the movie. He's supposed to be a dick at the beginning and then slowly work his way up to some sort of maturity towards the end of it.
Really? What sort of maturity?
Well, he just calms himself down.
Really?
He talks to a girl without shouting at her.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then tells her that she'd be pretty if her face wasn't screwing it up.
Yeah, but she gives him a
way to go, Mr. Charm.
There you go. That's exactly what I said.
It's the start of an abusive relationship.
Yeah. Yeah. That's pigtails in the ink. That's what that is.
Really?
Yes, it is. Yeah. I can hear it in your voice that you haven't looked at this film correctly.
What?
Because, no, I can hear it.
Is this an apple you're not holding the phone right?
No. Sort of thing. This is you still pissed off at the truffle shuffle and all that lot.
We'll get round to the truffle shuffle. The truffle shuffle, yes, that still bugs me immensely, but that's a different aspect of it. I mean, I there are kids' films like Stand By Me which do this kind of thing a lot better. But anyway, go on, carry on.
No, go on, man.
Because I mean, you know, go for it. Because I'm going to give everyone a fair crack of the whip, and you know, expect the same when I go off the rails and start crying.
I'm all right at the moment. I have seen the octopus piece as well.
Oh yeah.
I don't know if anyone else has seen.
How was it? I mean,
I can see why it didn't make the movie.
Yeah. Like the one from that Ed Wood movie?
Someone fighting like
Plan
a tentacle.
Nine. Yeah,
Plan 9.
It's pretty bad. There's a bit where Corey Feldman actually bites one of the tentacles of the octopus, and Data puts his Walkman in the octopus's mouth.
And
what, he plays More Than the Feeling, and then as it sinks beneath the waves,
it kind of does a backstroke like a man who's on fire.
Because it's eaten a Walkman.
Like a man inside an octopus suit drowning slowly while 12 kids attack him.
Go on, you go now, mate.
Okay, well, I guess it's probably not surprising I'm not impressed with this film. Moving on, well, let's not go into the truffle shuffle psychological dismemberment just yet. But I've got to say, the thing that's consistent throughout this film that I don't like is I don't like this weird rubbing of tones. It's like one minute it's an adult film that just happens to have kids in it. You know, things like sticking, you know, Chunk's hand in a blender, or, you know, things like the hanging, or things like, you know, the you know, oh, you're pissing me off, kid, fuck off. And it's all this swearing and gunfights, and it's kind of like, you know, it's more like a sort of young adult stroke adult movie, more like a gangster film or a criminal heist film. And it gets quite mean in places, and that's fine, you know, there's films like that. But then other times, it wants to have its cake and eat it. It wants to go from that to, oh, hello, everybody, we're all just friends together. Let's see the big jock riding on a little kid's bike and all this kind of thing. And have the sort of slapstick, slap on my thigh, here comes the eight-year-olds all laughing at the big kid driving off of a bridge. No, off of a cliff, doesn't he? He goes off a cliff.
Mm. Yeah. Mm.
And, you know, and it's... That's an example. It's not the whole thing.
But I don't think that's silly at all. I think that is more adult and more dark.
Yeah,
they're
exactly.
Looking at it the wrong way.
No, but But I'm just all I'm saying is it's like, you know, one minute we're having, oh, look, here's cute Data abseiling in through a window or through a screen door, and ha ha ha, isn't it a laugh? 2 seconds later, we've got Chunk trying to glue a cock back on. You know, and it's just this weird tonally. Just as a film, regardless of what I feel about the rest of it, tonally, it doesn't seem to be level. It seems like one minute it wants to be an adult comedy that kids can laugh at, that, you know, that adults can laugh at. And then 5 minutes later, it wants to be a screechy kids Disney movie, you know, Escape from Witch Mountain kind of thing. And then other times it goes, oh, no, now we've got to put a bit of threat in there. So let's have, you know, Chunk basically threatened with having his hand put in a blender. And then 2 seconds later, let's have a, ha, 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 look, you know, Data saved himself by using, you know, comedy teeth on a spring. And it just really kind of, you know, what is it? It almost feels like someone's trying to do the thing that happens with Gremlins and with Ghostbusters, which is, you know, that perfect balance of it's a horror film, but it's a comedy. And you're kind of cool with both because it sort of blends together quite nicely. But this one just feels like one minute we're in a sort of standard sort of mid-80s thriller, and the next minute we're in kids Indiana Jones film. And it feels odd all the way through. One minute watching them trying to work out the, you know, the sort of, oh, here comes a Rube Goldberg sort of rolling ball, and, you know, trying to work out sort of, you know, keys and, you know, Indiana Jones style plot traps, you know, which aren't as, you know, threatening as Indiana Jones plot traps. Next thing, you got like Chad or whatever his fucking name is trying to stare up Troy's trying to stare up a skirt using a wing mirror, and it's like, and it doesn't just show you him trying to do it, it's like, oh, let's have a look up the wing mirror for 5 minutes, you know, oh yeah, look, yeah, we are staring.
They seem to be quite a, yeah, I mean, you know, maybe it was just me, but did there seem quite an age difference between, you know, Troy and, yeah, what was her name?
Andy. Mm. Oh, yeah, and that's what I'm saying. I can see how kids would go for it, because it's like, it's almost aspirational cool thing for, like, anyone under the age of, like, 13, because it is that kind of, oh, yeah, you know, this is cool, you know, we can do all this sort of thing, and there's the whole coming of age thing, which is really nicely done in places. And then other times you've got the Fratellis beating the shit out of a disabled guy chained to a wall.
Well,
and it's like, huh, okay.
Well, looking at it now...
Dead bodies
in
the trunk.
I can see where you're coming from, but looking at it now, I see it's a much darker film than I remember it being.
Mm.
And yeah. I don't kind of see the happy going on an adventure stuff so much now, even though I still enjoy those bits. So maybe I've gone like in the other direction of you, in that I see the darker elements now.
Yeah.
But it doesn't bother me.
No. I mean, you know, this is me just watching it now. It's like, yeah, one minute they want a Hardy Boys adventure, next minute they want it to be fucking Streets of San Francisco or, you know, something like that. And it's just like, wow, how it just doesn't seem to ever settle on the tone. One minute the Fratellis are quite happy to kill a guy and stick him in the freezer and, you know, lug around a dead body like that, you know.
So whose dead body was in the car then, if the one was in the freezer?
I don't know.
It was two FBIs.
Oh, there was two?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, one minute we're quite happy to set fire to an entire jail and run away going, hee, 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 you know, like some sort of psychotic. 2 minutes later we're having, oh, I've slipped over on a log and I've hurt my bollocks, but yeah. I can't just fall over. I've got to do the Disney kind of, oh, cross my fingers, oh, thing. And it just, all the way through, the film just feels like 1 minute it doesn't know what, it does never knows what it's supposed to be. You know, we're going to get the big pirate ship thing and, you know, stupid fucking stuff with Sloth going, hey, yo, guys. And by the way, if I hear that phrase one more time,
what?
In,
are you guys? Oh, what, you mean Jesus. That one?
Damn,
every motherfucking other moment in that script, whenever they didn't say something, one of them had to go, hey, you guys. It's like, yeah, that's not a catchphrase. That's just fucking annoying.
They needed to establish it for when he says it at the end.
Yeah.
He's a Goonie.
Yeah. Lovely.
Yeah.
Well done.
Yeah, I think I've been a bit harsh as well with saying, oh, look at the Fratellis beating up the disabled guy chained to the wall.
What was he doing?
It's not meant to be set out that way. It's meant to be, oh, look at this hideous monster, which is redeemed at halfway through the movie and towards the end where everyone loves him.
Yeah, but I mean, this is that was just one example out of about half a dozen. That's what I'm talking about. You're getting sequences of torture and dead bodies in a film which 5 minutes earlier had, oh, look, we're all having fun and having a kiddies Indiana Jones Hardy Boys adventure, which they even mention Hardy Boys.
Yeah.
And it's just like, that's more my point. Not whether or not that specific instance is, you know, wrong. It was just more a case of like, are you trying to be a dark thriller with kids in it? Are you trying to do a sort of like Fright Night? Are you trying to do something like that, or Gremlins, where it's a comedy but it's a horror? Or are you trying to do light, frothy, da 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 da, or going to save everyone?
I think they're trying to get somewhere in the middle, but have it a little bit darker so you would enjoy it on rewatches. And also, you got a lot of parents going to the cinema to take their kids to watch this. And so they need to be entertained. And I feel if they are gripped in that, then they might retain the memories of going and watch it and actually want to see it again.
I think there's, you know, thinking about how this film goes, I think there is a positive message that it's trying to get out there. Take a look at people like Sloth and Sean Astin's character with the asthma and stuff like this, and it's like, you know, just because you may have an affliction like that doesn't mean to say that you're totally useless and you can achieve stuff if you really put your mind to it and you really believe in yourself, you know. So I think there is that's trying to get out movie that is in there.
I did want an asthma pump after watching this movie when I was a kid.
Really?
Is that a euphemism?
No. I wanted an asthma pump. I thought that was really cool.
Hello, Andy. I'm going to have an asthma pump, Andy.
And and braces.
Yeah, and braces, yeah. I mean, like I say, maybe if you want to say I'm being harsh on it, fine. You know what? I'll take that criticism. But personally, I feel like this film just was trying to jump on that Gremlins bandwagon. It was trying to jump on that fine balance between, you know, one thing and another. That thing which they later perfected with things like Evil Dead 2, which was like clearly a comedy but a horror film. You know, and like I say, Gremlins and Ghostbusters and all these other ones which kind of really blend those two up really nicely. But this just seemed to be 1 minute the seriousness is on, next minute the seriousness is off. And it just weird. It just felt weird all the way through it. And as Darren kind of alluded to, none of these kids would be friends. Just absolutely not. Yeah. The fat kid would, if he had an ounce of self-respect, he would not be within 100 yards of any of them. And yet, every single one of them takes the piss out of him at least once. The script just absolutely turns him into nothing but a whiny food machine. That's essentially it. There's no redemption for Chunk. There's no moment of realization.
Hang on, he takes Sloth home with him.
Yes, he does. But the point is, there's no redemption in the eyes of his peers. Everyone fucking hates him. Everyone thinks he's a joke. And then when he turns up at the end and he's still screaming, all they're still doing is still taking the piss out of him because he's, you know, his only script motivation is, I can smell pizza. You know, they're about to get killed by the Fratellis. They're hiding in the fucking ship, and yet somehow he still can't keep his mouth shut. while scared to death, going, pizza, is that pepperoni or is that cheese and tomato?
It's like sloth bond over food as well.
Yeah.
With the ice cream.
Yeah, and the Babe Ruth.
Yeah.
Rocky Road.
Yeah, but that's the point. And it's like that I found I really hated that. Now, okay, yes, the truffle shovel thing, yes, I got the piss taken out of me, and yes, people asked me to do it, and yes, it kept going, and la 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 la, and, you know, that's a discussion for a completely different podcast about psychotherapy in the 80s.
I was going to say, that's actually a psychotherapy session. That is, yeah.
But the point is, someone like Mouth, someone like Chunk would not want to be anywhere near, and Mouth is an arsehole. He's absolutely an arsehole, and the film fucking panders to him all the way through, and then they try to make him understandable by having him pick up some random coin, you know, some random ass coin, and go, that used to be my dreams and it's down here, I'm taking everything. And it's like, yeah, what is that related to? Is that related to your parents? Is that related to something else going on? What, you know, at some point there was some bit in the script clearly that said Mouth is the way he is because something happened, and that doesn't, you know, and that's the end of it.
Well, at the beginning he was with his dad at his job, so maybe there is no mother,
maybe, but you never know, you never find out, nothing's ever said, but you know, he's a bitter, twisted bully of a cunt of a kid, and genuinely I disliked him from the start when he walks in and he's like, oh yeah, and he's trying to do the fucking Fonz thing with his hair, and then he makes Chunk do the truffle shuffle, then the next thing you know he's just running around taking the piss out of everyone. Then he fucks off and annoys the, you know, the fucking housemaid.
The maid.
Yeah, fucks around with her. And then on top of that, once he does that, you don't believe anything he's saying in Spanish. I found that all the way through. I'm thinking, why on the fucking earth are anyone listening to him?
Well, because they're doing,
he could be saying a load of old bullshit.
But on the map, he wants to get the stuff as well.
Does he? We never really find that out. He just stands there and he only sort of jumps on board because everyone's going that way.
Well, you're never... I mean, at the beginning, I was never sure whether he knew what he was saying to the maid or not. Obviously, now I know he was lying on purpose.
Mm.
But I never got that he was trying to mislead them in any way.
He's a malicious, malevolent, snidey
arsehole.
Although
it's amazing how they made the verses rhyme in Spanish and in English.
I didn't care.
They, yeah.
I'll be honest with you.
Well, no, it rhymed in English, but it wouldn't in Spanish. So on the map. When he's reading the bit about the piano that she has to play.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The piano stuck on the floating island.
Yeah.
Because obviously that wasn't connected to anything when you saw it from underneath. And the next button that they were going to press was going to make the whole lot drop away.
Yeah.
So what was it connected to?
But what a great scene for kids to look at and go, you know, the piano looked great.
Look, I'm not knocking the production design, which was good. The way it was filmed, clearly a Spielberg thing. Donna can do action. My point is that I disliked the characters and the script and the tone of the film. The characters. Sean Astin's character gets mollycoddled to within an inch of his life by his brother, by his mother, and then he goes on this whole one-eyed Willy quest, and in the end, what? Nothing. You know, they get some gems purely by accident, and that's the end of it. He's not evolved or changed or anything, except you get one scene at the very end where he goes, who needs it, while he's still wheezing with fucking asthma. Okay, well, okay, fine, we've learned what. Next thing you know, Andy spends the entire film either screaming or acting like, I've got a lovely body, haven't I? Haven't I got a lovely body? He's going to snog me. He's going to snog me. I'm going to make this moment of snogging him. So basically, she's just this sex object, just to kind of cart around. Because it's either her going with Josh Brolin, or it's her going up the fucking well to Troyland. And, you know, and all she is she's just a trophy to go for. And that all the way through has bothered me, because it was just like, oh, so you kissed him. Oh, I'm going to make this moment. It's like, not, oh, I'm going to go for a piss, or I'm going to hide in the cupboard, or, you know, I'm going to try and find a way out or sort anything out. All the way through, all she's doing is going, I'm going to kiss him. I'm going to kiss him. And it's like, what? Is that your entire thing? And that was the problem. All of the script just had one character trait for that character, and that character would repeatedly do it. And that
but
was
when,
it.
When you're that age, that's important to you.
It might be important to you, but what is it telling you? What is it making you think?
Well, when
that it's okay to bully kids? Or if you're fat, you should just carry on eating?
No, but kids are kids, and they will, you know, from here until the end of time, kids will bully other kids.
Kids are
there's no getting away with that.
No.
Kids will always think about, oh, I want to kiss him, and then run it over and over and over in their mind again.
Yeah, but the thing is, you're trying to tell a story here. You know, you're not trying to say, oh, this is an accurate representation of kids in a school or something. This is an adventure story. So hasn't she got something to actually do? And then all she does is she gets the fucking piano bit. And all that happens there is she presses a couple of buttons, and then that's it. Her entire plot involvement is done. Until Josh Brolin decides that, oh, while she's halfway through drowning underneath the water, he won't bother untying her. He'll just stick his hand. He'll just stick his head underneath between her arms and give her a good old snog.
Actually, no, she does that to him. She puts her arms over the top of him and catches him and pulls him in for a kiss.
Does she?
Yeah.
But does she?
No, she...
That didn't look like that to me.
No, she did. Right. Now, she is the one obsessed with all that going on. You got Josh Brolin's character at one point. You know, after she's kissed Sean Astin, she's coming looking at him like, you know, Let's go over here. And he's like, are you fucking mental? Can you not see what the fuck is going on over there? We're about to die, you silly person.
But that's just what I'm saying. That's the whole thing. And then you got Martha Plimpton or whatever her name is. Oh, you know, she's just the ugly hanger-on until like halfway through when she shouts at fucking Mouth and tells him to shut the fuck up. And then he gets all, oh, I'm so hurt. And it's like, really? Oh, right, so you've spent the entire fucking film shitting on everyone else, and as soon as someone slaps you back, you have to go, oh, no, this is my penny, and my dreams have been ruined.
So I'm going to take every single penny in the...
Yeah, so I'm going to nick everyone's.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could have quite happily drowned him. I could have punched him to the floor and kicked him in the bollocks and just left him with a rock around his
punched
neck.
Punched him on the one-eyed willy.
There we go. Yeah. And then you've got Data, whose sole purpose is purely to stand there and come out with crazy, crazy gadgets. So and basically be misunderstood because he is Chinese and he is foreign or whatever.
I must admit, I did like the bit where he kind of just sits there and he's losing it very quietly and mumbling away to himself. I did like that bit. Well, it's just, he's going, fucking, you fucking bunch of twats. Oh, yeah, yeah, tell me to do this, tell me to do that, and then I'll do this, blah, 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 blah. But it's just that it seemed very natural, that bit there, where he was just like, you know, going and just mumbling away to himself. He's just like, fuck them all. They can all fucking die.
Yeah, well, that's kind of how I felt by about halfway through. I mean, no, seriously, because it was just that whole thing of just, I didn't like them. I didn't like any of them. And the fact that they were all just one note didn't make me like them more. It made me hate the writer.
Yeah.
And that's the problem. I think The Heart of the Goonies is a really good film. I do. I do and genuinely think that, it, you know, if someone was to remake it now and sort of go over it a little bit, smooth over the cracks a bit, you'd end up with a better film.
I think Elton's got a point in that I know it's not meant to be realistic because it's an adventure film, but the way that they were talking to one another and, like, they were swearing.
They
not
weren't
many...
talking to one another. They were shouting.
Yeah, exactly. So
all
one minute,
the time.
One minute they're shouting at each other. The next minute they're going, Goonies never die. Don't go away. We need you. That's what kids are like. And yes, it's infuriating, but that's why I kind of like, and it's really realistic. They're swearing, you know, not many children's films that they're swearing at each other and shouting at each other and...
You get no argument from me on that stuff.
I like how it's realistic. Like, they were saying how Donna was making them react rather than act because he was giving them cues to actually react to things rather than tell them what to do. I think that's probably why you're annoyed or pissed off at it, is actually because it was more realistic than any other kind
of... You hate children.
kids suck. No.
But it's why I think that Darren hates Attack the Block, because the characters in that were so realistic that every fucking arsehole and every tower block in the city that you just want to... And that's... But for me, that means it's a good film.
But
I mean?
No, okay. just using Attack the Block as an example, the thing with that, as well as the Goonies and everything else, is you have to at some point sympathise with the main character if they're in danger. If you hate them from day one, if you hate them from the first scene right through to the moment they're in danger and you wish they were dead, then the chances are that film's failed, regardless of how real it is. Brilliant. You've given us an absolutely real rendition of some arsehole in a block that you would actually quite happily run over because he's just basically mugged a nurse and demanded with entitlement that you've got to come and fix his boy because his boy is like the man and do whatever. And it's like,
And you've got to be grateful because I've just saved your life. And it's like, well, no, you didn't save her life. She actually ended up in that fucking ambulance by accident.
Yeah.
And you're trying to take credit for her. And, that's obviously you're absolved of... This is a podcast. This is something for another time. I'm going to sit here. I'm going to go on.
Yeah.
Right? I'm going to be you for that film.
Yeah,
right?
No, don't worry. I'll be me for that film. But the thing with Attack the Block, as well as the Goonies, is at some point, you have to have that epiphany moment of the characters where you kind of turn around and go, okay, I get it. You know, they tried it with Mouth, with that scene in the well. They tried to make him suddenly, like, sympathetic. But it doesn't. It comes across as whiny. Why? Because you don't know why he's moaning about his fucking penny, which clearly isn't his penny. He's just made it up.
Plus, also, he then goes down and proceeds to take every other penny. So he's, you know, sort of a metaphor for crushing everyone else's dreams. Yeah. There you go. Yeah.
But that's the
he's
point.
A shit.
You get, yeah, he is an absolute cunt.
He is.
But the thing is, you know, so that's the thing. You kind of sit there going, no, I don't feel anything for this guy. I don't. You've tried really hard, but you've given me nothing at the beginning, nothing at the end, and all you've given me is a scene where someone's actually told him to shut up and now he's going to cry about it. And it's like, yeah, but you didn't give a shit when you were making Fat Boy dance. You didn't give a shit when you were ruining all that stuff in the loft. You didn't give a shit when you were telling, you know, fucking Spanish people that, you know, that they won't ever come back to this house, you know, because you've scared the shit out of them. You didn't give a shit about any of that, but then all of a sudden we've all got to give a shit about you. No, the script's done. That is an undeserved moment of pathos. It doesn't exist. I don't care if you're a kid or whatever. You hate that kid from the get-go. Or if you think he's cool, maybe you're a sociopath. The point is, I didn't like him. I don't care. I don't care whether or not that means, you know, kids are like that. Brilliant. Kids are like that. But I hate those kids as well. As simple as that. And that's the problem, you know. There are nice kids, and there are kids who are good, and there are kids who... But they're not a one note. You don't have one kid just walk in and the only thing they can say is, I want a sandwich, I want a sandwich, I want a sandwich for 2 hours in a film. Or, I've got some gadgets, I've got some gadgets, I've got some gadgets. You don't understand what I'm saying because I've got too many teeth in my mouth. Or, you know, or I'm a cunt, I'm a cunt, I'm a cunt, I'm a cunt, I'm a cunt. Oh, you hate me. Now fuck off. The one with the most character arc was actually Bloody Sloth. He starts off as a monster, and then by the end of it, you understand he's a childlike idiot who just, you know, wants a friend and wants a family and wants to be loved because he has the whole thing with the mum. And it's like, okay, that's an arc. That's a story arc. Mm. You know, and that's the problem. You know, that's the core of this entire film for me. None of these characters do anything other than just have one trait. It's like someone pulled a card out and said, You are now Oriental we don't understand with gadgets. You are cunt. You are asthma boy driving plot along. You are brother who can lift things because you're strong. You are sex object with short skirt. You know, who doesn't wear short skirt when she's actually supposed to be, when she's doing cheerleading, but only does it because, you know, that would drive the sales up for the pervs when they're watching for falling over and, my skirt's gone up again. Woo! And you are ugly friend who's coming along to act as actors, sort of like reason to be the pretty one over here. You know, it's just they were just fucking stereotypes running around. And the kids love it. Well, fine, yeah. But kids love Cat from Outer Space or Underdog, as I watched the other week, which is shit. And has Peter Dinklage in it as a mad scientist. That was
what?
Yeah, you should watch that. Tyrion Lannister walking around with a crutch going, I've made super dogs. And it's like, no. But the point is, Goonies is that kind of dumb one-note writing that the 80s used to love. They used to love that shit. That's why things like Raiders stands out, or Empire Strikes Back stands out, or Gremlins, because you actually had characters that started off in one place and ended in somewhere completely different. Whereas Goonies, they start off as cunts, they end as cunts, except they've got a guy with a wonky eye in their gang now. That's it. That's the only thing that changes. That's the only thing that changes. And then, you know, it's completely consequence-free filmmaking. Absolutely. And I just hated it. I just hated it because I just hated what they were. And I hated that that people sit there and go, oh, why haven't you liked this film? And it's like, because I was that fat kid making the dancing. I was a person hanging around bullies like that. I was a guy standing there while other people bullied other people and you couldn't do anything except look there and go, oh, well, let's pretend we're having an adventure. You know, it's everything. It's like when you were a young kid and you went from primary school to secondary school and someone shows you Grange Hill and you think, fuck going to secondary school. When you're in secondary school and you're watching Grange Hill, you go, oh, that's a load of old toss.
Yep.
But the thing is, that is the same thing. Goonies is just what it's like to be a single-minded cunt. That's all it is, with a bit of Indiana Jones thrown in there. And no continuity. Because when Robert Davi's sitting in his car singing while Chunk's going, ah, like that, you look, there's a shot where he's in the mirror and he's got a fag in his mouth. How's he managing to sing? But anyway, that's a nitpick. That's a nitpick.
Yeah, I was going to say, people can sing with a fag in their mouth.
Not like he was.
When the mum puts her hand out for the thing at the end, she puts two hands out, but one of them's in a cast.
Yeah.
How did she do that?
I don't know.
Magic.
Maybe she's responsible for the alien egg in Alien 3. I don't know. But anyway, so yeah, I just, no. Goonies is not a film that ever struck home with me, and when it did, it struck home for the wrong reasons. So there.
So yeah, you've been burned by this, haven't you?
Should we do feedback?
We will do feedback, but you know what? Yes, I have been burnt by this film, but you know what? If you show this to your kids and one of them ends up putting his tongue through your fucking priceless heirlooms...
I beg your pardon?
Yeah.
Phrasing.
Phrasing. Don't come crying to me. And if your daughter or whatever grows up and she suddenly realises the only thing in her only purpose in life is to shag this guy whose only purpose in life seems to be to use a fucking Stairmaster properly. I mean, it's just like... Josh Brolin's character is just... What? I can stretch these springs. I can stretch these springs.
He's not brand. He's bland.
See what I did there? Shall we do feedback?
Yes.
Now put your hands up. Here online. Doing real fine. We're doing our podcasting. It's called Black Dog. It's not like a job. Is anyone there listening? What do you think of our show? Let us know by MP3 or email. Just get it to us. It ain't no fuss. We'll even read your Twitter rings. Cause if you like us or you hate us, send some feedback in. Got a geek and points and rates and put some feedback in. Even think my voice is sexy, put some feedback in. Man, we really like it if you put some feedback in. Oh, 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 oh.
Right, feedback time. Right, so first piece of feedback is from Jack P. Starro, and he writes... Sorry, I'm going to turn the iPad around the other way so I can read the whole thing. Yes, it's actually entitled One-Eyed Willy's Inappropriate Panty Shots. And he starts, Dear Grumpy, Sleepy, Dopey, and Holiday-y, because he's obviously talking about Jim.
Yes.
But it'll do for you. You can be Holiday.
I'm Snow White, obviously.
Okay. What, you mean you're asleep?
Yeah.
Someday my prince will come.
Anyway, Jack carries on. Welcome to the hell of other people's nostalgia. Well, no, not exactly. You see, I managed to get through the first three decades of my life without succumbing to the metronomic regularity of annoying peers discovering with gobsmacked horror that I'd never seen one of their two favourite childhood classics, to wit, "Oh, what do you mean you've never seen The Princess Bride?" And, "What do you mean you've never seen The Goonies? What's wrong with you?" Well, a year or two back, I finally got sick of it and watched The Princess Bride for the first time. And although it was amusing enough, I really couldn't see what all the damned fuss was about. Ooh. It remains a head-scratcher as to why people love that film so intensely, to which I can only conclude it's a nostalgia thing. You kind of had to be there at the time. And, unlike spurious claims to the contrary and an interesting yet annoyingly written article posted on the Facebook group, I really don't begrudge people their nostalgia, as I have a great deal of it myself.
I'm looking at the microphone very sternly now.
It's fine. For what it's worth, we did cover The Princess Bride quite early on.
We did, yeah.
And
everyone fucking loves it.
Yeah.
I haven't seen it yet.
Oh, what do you mean you've never seen The Princess Bride?
So hold on a minute. Hold on. You've seen, you're up to date with Game of Thrones.
Yep.
Anyway, it doesn't matter.
He's Merlin. He's living backwards.
Yeah, no, he's Benjamin Button.
Oh, Benjamin Button.
Anyway, no, the thing with Princess Bride is because it was the first of those kind of irreverent, tongue-in-cheek kind of takes on that sort of genre. It's become old hat now, but yeah. Anyway, moving on. So, he continues. That said, The Goonies was a perfect storm of potential nostalgic oversaturation for me. I've been begrudgingly getting round to watching it with my mate Mark after the umpteenth exclamation, and then Lazza programmed it for yon doggery, and I figured I'd clinched it. But then, while trying to sort out for some timing with our mutual friend Tom, at the whose place we watch Game of Thrones each week, we caught wind of these plans, and I was once again smacked in the face with a cry of, "What do you mean you've never seen The Goonies?" Upon intoning this blast, Tom then ran downstairs to get his wife, Les. Can you believe Jack's never seen The Goonies? To which I hear wafting up the stairs, "What the fuck? How can he have never seen The Goonies?" And then, while being quizzed on what year I was born in the vague hopes of some explanation as to how I could have missed it, Les's brother shambles in and absently asks, "Who the fuck's never seen The Goonies?" All of which led me to wonder, is this how people who've never watched Star Wars feel all the fucking time? Anyway, basically, I got lovingly dragooned into watching it with the whole family, including their 10-year-old kid, who had seen it before, multiple times in fact, and the following weekend. I was happy to do so, as it was my plan to watch it anyway, but as the film started with much fanfare from the assembled around me, I couldn't help but imagining back in the back of my mind our resident grumpmeister Lee being transposed into the same situation, simmering with Bruce Banner-like white-knuckled intensity as those around practically cudgel him in the ears with cheerful comments like, "Well, do you like it? It's great, isn't it? Ooh, wait for this bit. It's great. I still can't believe you've never seen it before." Yeah, I must admit, if any fucker did that to me, they'd be eating the chair. That's, yeah.
Yeah.
You've never seen it before? No, I fucking haven't. And I can't fucking watch it now while you're fucking talking in my fucking ear, cunts. Anyway, take the kid out of the room. I'm going to swear. Anyway, Jack continues. Until finally turning purple and going to a bile-spewed rampage of mutually assured destruction in the living room. Oh, yeah, there you go. Well, fortunately for all concerned, this was not my reaction. I kind of liked it. And not a lot, to be fair, but unlike The Princess Bride, I could definitely see why kids would have loved it back in the day. It also benefited from not having been constantly quoted at me ad nauseum over the years, as it had been with the case with The Princess Bride, such that when I finally saw it, I felt I knew already half the script. The Goonies, by comparison, I knew very little of what was going on, which helped. It was fun to see so many familiar actors when they were younger, although it was definitely few too many panty shots for one girl. The other one, with the glasses, I'd actually known from a fantastic TV show called The Good Wife, so it was odd to see how little she'd actually aged in 30 years. Neither is Robert Davi, but I guess that's heavy features and bad skin will do for you. Otherwise, Short Round was fine, Young Samwise was charismatic, Chunk was junk, and the not-Batman-come-Thanos was just kind of disturbing. That's just brilliant.
Yes. Mm.
The plot was pretty damn paper thin, and I think the main appeal of this film was for people like Lego Wonderkind Mark was clearly the Rube Goldbergian nature of the set pieces, which were completely absurd and also really quite charming in and of themselves. The ridiculous bone pipe organ with the fallaway floors was all kind of silly awesomeness, even if they could never quite stop thinking to myself that some poor fucker had to actually build all that shit underground. Kind of like Alfred in the Batcave, you know? But yeah, ultimately, I think it's a nostalgia thing. I can see why they liked it, but coming to it fresh for the first time, I think you just had to be there. Love and murdered nostalgia, Jack. There you go.
Sounds reasonable.
Sounds reasonable?
Mm-hmm. Where he said about he was thinking about someone building it underground for so many years. Mm. They did say at the start of the movie, didn't they, that One-Eyed Willie was trapped by the British for 6 years.
With an infinite amount of resources, rope and traps and and like several thousand tons worth of lifting equipment to lift all those boulders into place and hook them up on chains.
Yeah.
And when they got bored, they built water slides.
And then when they got bored, they built water slides and a giant octopus. Yeah. Nice. And then built a massive, fantastic 700-foot high trapdoor for your boat to sail through automatically.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, huh?
Yeah, it would collapse with a certain press of a button. Technology we don't even own today, but there you go. I'm going to stop. Anyway, thank you very much for that, Jack. I think it's probably the most reasonable feedback we'll get tonight. Mm. But anyway, well, I say that, but, you know, who's to say? Because Darren's got the next one, and who is it?
This one is Martin Thompson.
Aha.
With an email entitled, "Can You Smell One-Eyed Willie?" Okay,
I can see where this is going.
Martin writes, "Dear Lee, Darren, Elton, and Jim,
and Laura."
And Jim, if he's back from his Grecian jaunt. So then, to that size-iced piece of shit, or 80s shit, The Goonies. This is actually the first time I've seen this film all the way through, and due to much of the same psychological scarring that Lee was talking about last week, as a less than svelte young man in school, I was often asked to do the truffle shuffle, and so I hated the film without seeing a single shot. I vaguely recall watching some of it years ago with my cousin, and I knew it would always fall within the purview of the Blackdog, as it's such a cult 80s classic. Watching it now, I found it enjoyable. Seeing anything 80s always makes me nostalgic. At least the kids were bearable in this and there was some fun dialogue. The translation sequence made me laugh out loud. Did Andy remind anyone else of Emma Watson too?
No.
Not really, no.
Well, you know.
No.
Okay.
This is a film that would not get made today, though. And it's surprising how dark it is. It opens with a man pretending to hang himself, for fuck's sake. Then there's Sloth too. What exactly was his role other than to rescue Chunk? He's deformed, supposedly, because his mum dropped him on his head a few times. That's very grim for kids. That's very grim for a kids' film. They all exit the cage through his legs too, right under the crotch. You couldn't get away with that amount of one-eyed Willy jokes either. Anyway, I felt the film sagged a bit in the middle, but it was a decent enough story and an overall enjoyable piece of 80s comedy. Cheers, Martin.
Thank you very much for that, Martin. Okay. Well, I'm more on Martin's side, I'll be honest. But even then, he still enjoys it, whereas I didn't. There you go. So, we'll move on to the next piece of feedback.
This is from Ollie Peters.
Ollie Peters, Six Global.
And it's entitled "Goonies Never Say Die." Hail the four dudesketeers
and Laura.
Dudesketeers.
Yeah.
Well, if Jim is back off holes and Elton, well, if Elton turns up, that is. Well, enough of the pleasantries. Let's crack
He's
on.
He's not playing fucking bingo.
Goonies. I fucking love it.
Yes.
I don't care what anyone else says, especially Lee, has to say about this film.
I've been watching. Fuck you, Lee. Fuck you.
Yeah. Fuck you, the eye. Your one eye.
Your one eye. The one eye, Willie.
With, yeah, fuck you in the one eye with Willie.
I've been watching this film since the dawn of my time, and I'll watch it whenever it's on TV, at whatever point it's on. Yeah, Darren will attest to that with me.
Yep.
Though I do get annoyed watching it on 5. They keep cutting it. It was on some channel not too long ago, late night, and I wondered why this was. Ah, it's uncut, that's why. So balls to everyone. Goonies never say die. Ollie Triple Six Claw Paw Shuffle.
Well, fantastic. Well, well done, Ollie, for cementing my opinion of you.
See you at the shindig.
See you at the shindig when I give you the truffle shuffle, all right? Anyway.
Thank you, Ollie. I'm glad I got to read that one out.
Thank you, Ollie. So, Elton, who do you have next?
I have Phil Bellamy.
Uh-huh.
And he entitles his email, Goonies Are Good Enough.
Oh,
Goonies are good enough.
No. There's no singing. No singing. Keep, go.
I'll go.
Go.
Good evening in... Good evening, Inspectors Lee, Darren, Jim, and Commissioner Elton.
And Laura.
Yeah, First Officer Laura.
As a child of the 80s, I was born in 1980. Oh, dear. Like many of others of my age, I grew up with this film and have had rose-tinted specs firmly for this film ever since. I remember seeing it as a young age on VHS, and it ended up being one of those tapes in the collection that was worn due to the amount of watches. Yeah. It's just one of those films I always watched as a kid when there was nothing else to do, and that was a lot.
Mm-hmm.
What's not to love about it, though? Well, a bunch of kids follow a treasure map and go on a big adventure that involves traps, pirate ships, dead bodies, and the truffle shuffle! Exclamation mark. But it's by no means a kids only film. There's plenty of in jokes for the adults too. A young Corey Feldman is brilliant. His translating bit for the new cleaning lady is still hilarious now. Chunk, love him or hate him, is brilliant comic relief. His facial expressions throughout are hilarious, in particular the scene where he's trapped in the cooler with the dead body leaning on him. But overall, it's a great feel-good fun film. I grew up loving this film, and it will always hold a special place in my heart. Seeing you, Phil Bellamy.
Thank you very much for that, Phil. Do you know what? I'm going to come out and say the only thing I liked about it, the only scene I actually liked about it, the bit when they caught Chunk, and then they said, right, spill it, everything. And he basically does the entire life history of every misdemeanor he's ever done.
Yeah.
I thought that was good because I actually was laughing more at Robert Davi in the background, who clearly couldn't keep his mouth straight.
So
Yeah, he was laughing all the way through it. So I was kind of laughing at the reactions of the actors. Yeah, the screw up. But again, you know, born in the 80s, gotta love it. It's official. Otherwise, I have to turn in my 80s badge. Or something.
Well, that's just you feeling old, isn't it, Lee?
No, I'm not feeling old. I fucking am old.
Is that too?
I mean, no. I've watched films in the 80s which are cynical and stupid and kids' films, and I like them. I just don't like Goonies because they're all full of cunts. They are. Every single man jack one of them.
Okay.
And Sloth should have been done for assaulting a police officer at the end.
That's true.
They call everyone down, they cool it all down, and then the fucking idiot picks a policeman up by his throat. Nice. Well done. As the police draw a bead on him and shoot him down. But no.
And Chuck's like, come home with me. And his mother's like, what?
Yeah, what? This guy
can't. The thing is, though, this film is a live action cartoon, really, isn't it? And so it has got that cartoon aspect to it.
It's a live action cartoon now, is it?
Yeah.
That's the next excuse. Okay.
No, it's not an excuse. I'm just saying it does feel like a cartoon that has been brought to life. They live in a cartoon world, don't they?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm just thinking, you know, something like Dungeons and Dragons with, like, Uni, the bloody unicorn, which always, just as they're about to leave, decides that, you know, after helping them all the way through, turns around and goes, and then they decide they can't go through the fucking portal again. Fuck off then. Stop helping us, or fuck off, or come with us. I don't care which, but I want to go home for my tea. Oh, poor uni. Fuck off, uni. I'm going to take your fucking horn off and kick you down a well. prove I've done something. Anyway, yes. So, fucking 80s cartoons going to sod off. Anyway, bugger it. Right, so I'll move on to my next piece of feedback. And it is Michael Cornett. And he does the blog dustandcorruption.blogspot.com, and he writes, "I got your one-eyed willy right here." Greetings, gentlemen from Baltimore, the land of crack and unicorns. Oh, there you go. Ah, Goonies, the perviest kids film ever. Just watch it. We have an older brother working out constantly, trying to be top cock, and then we have Chunk, who's clearly the sub to everyone else's dom. And then there's a brief appearance by that fag hag Cindy Lauper. And then we have kids mauling the nude statues and finally giving it an erection. Goonies become bizarre psychosexual homoerotic journey. Mothers are either vapid or oblivious, Mike and Brandon's mum, or psycho Harridans, Mrs. Fratelli. Rich kid Troy wants to hold Brandon's hand. Jake Fratelli escapes from Sausage Fest at the jail and then sits around singing opera. Boys will pursue the legendary one-eyed Willy, while, like, anyone needs that explaining to them. And what about the scene where they all play one-eyed Willy's organ, or in the country club, or is it the sex club, where they have naked men dealing with plumbing and the teenage boy calling for his daddy? And all the while, the kids are crawling around wet urethra-like passages to find the one-eyed Willy. Ultimately, it has a two-way resolution. Chunk reconnects with his rampaging id of sloth and breaks out of his sub role and takes on the pirate role to save the others. And we all know what about pirates. Rum, lashes, you know the rest. And young Mikey discards his inhaler when he shows up with the jewels and is able to save the family home when his parents couldn't, because he's connected with One Eye Willy. He symbolically castrates his ineffectual father and then establishes himself as top cock of the family. And if anyone takes any of the proceedings seriously, they're a fucking idiot. Okay, now, seriously now, Goonies is hailed as a now classic kids film. My problem is that when it came out, I was 20 years old. I went to see it with friends, and while I was diverted by some of it, I found it just too kiddie orientated for me. I did like the pipe organ made of bones, and I thought Sean Austin was actually pretty good. The veteran character actress Anne Ramsey here was enjoying something of a career renaissance, and is reliable stalwart. But so much of the comedy is cringe-inducing, the characters are all too stereotyped, and I kept wanting to slap Ke-Hui Kwan, who I found intolerable, and I guess I was just too old for it. Even as a kid, this probably wouldn't have appealed to me, and I would have wanted more bloodshed, some pirate ghosts, and some John Muse Matsuak out of makeup in a bathing suit. And anyone yelling, "Hey, you guys, get shot." Sincerely, Michael Belly Stapler Cornett, dustandcorruption.blogspot.com. Thank you very much for that, Michael. There you go.
Indeed. Cheers.
Thanks. Yeah. Cool. So, anyone got anything to add to that? A psychosexual journey through...
Well, Darren did spoil the movie for me by pointing out the whole one-eyed Willy thing. When he first saw it with me years and years ago, I'd never even thought of that.
And playing one-eyed Willy's organ is genius.
I'm blaming Darren for the... Yeah,
well, that's the second... that's the two... There are two films that Laura absolutely adores from the 80s.
Mm.
This one and the other one is Labyrinth. Now, I did the same thing there when I kept noticing. Have you noticed David Bowie's Hobgoblin there?
His one-eyed Willy showing.
Exactly. David Bowie and his tight pants. I've got a laughing gun.
Two of my childhood movie favourites that Darren has spoiled for me now.
Yeah.
What about the babe? Fuck the babe. Look at my bulge.
I'm Labyrinth David Bowie and I've got my glass balls.
Our mate is David Bowie.
Bowie's in space.
What you doing of there, man?
No.
Oh, he's dropped the iPad.
I've dropped the iPad. Such is the power of Bowie.
Bowie's yep. cock.
Bowie's cock and his big balls. Tina Turner hair. Yep. Yeah. But anyway. All right. Well, thank you very much for that, Michael. Moving back to the feedback section. Yeah. Thanks very much for that, Michael. And again, you can read more of Michael's ramblings and thoughts and stuff on dustandcorruption.blogspot.com. Right, Elton, who do we have last on our piece of written feedback?
Hang on a sec. We have... Oh, balls.
We have balls.
Dave Renane.
Happy Dave.
Yes. Mm. The subject is penis euphemisms and the Freudian tunnel of lost childhood.
Oh, my word. Go on in.
Hello, chaps. I hope you all have a good week and Jim enjoyed his holiday. He's not back yet.
No.
Also, congratulations to Elton for a sterling first effort as the fourth chair. Oh, thank you very much. While I may not agree with all of his theories, I got everything he was trying to say and look forward to his insights this week. Don't let Lee wear you down. Oh, dear. I think he already has, to be honest.
No. Come on.
Right. So, on to the film. Paging Mr. Saville. We have some happy childhood memories require your special attention.
Who's your best pal? Jingly jangly. jewelry. Sorry, carry on.
Now, I can remember when Phantom Menace came out and there was an argument that the new films were a tap for children rather than the quality entertainment that we watched when we were, well, children. So it's interesting to contrast this argument by actually watching something that is unashamedly tat for children. Interesting, rather teeth-grindingly painful in places. I must have been about 12 or 13 when The Goonies came out and remember rather enjoying it. It was the 80s, and I also thought Cyndi Lauper could carry a tune, and Rolf Harris was wholesome family entertainment. Although we now know why they had to tie that kangaroo down, allegedly.
Also, two little boys takes on a whole new meaning as well.
Yep.
Two little boys had two little toys. Oh, I've come.
Anyway, when the big guy will leave you crying.
I can also remember reading the novelization and swapping some of the bubblegum cards and being roundedly disappointed that the octopus promise in both never made it to the film. Finding it now on YouTube after all these years is something of a disappointment. Sort of like Lee with Alien 3, but with the PG rating.
Thanks.
Maybe it's the kid in me talking, but the 80s really were a completely different world. From the comedy villains threatening to put a chunk's hand in the blender, to the casual meanness of the truffle shovel.
Yes.
There's a lot of stuff in there that you could not get away with today. I'm not advocating screening kids for the darker part of the real world, but if you think about it, from the broken penis gag, let alone one-eyed Willy, to the mild swearing from death-defying stunts, don't try these at home, to the kids' films opening with the fake suicide, there may be more innocent but somehow earthier times. I'm sure Darren has already
eviscerated.
The Tudegeddon nightmare that is mouth. But barely 10 minutes in, he's talking about hard drugs and sexual torture devices. And after someone pointed it out on the Facebook page, the shortness of that skirt cannot be unseen.
Yeah.
Actually, the weird thing about the gym slip that she's wearing, something far more practical in cheerleading practice. So the question of why she ends up dressed like that is still left hanging. But the most surprising never happened today thing that most of this takes place in the first half hour where they build the characters and the story before starting the adventure properly. Nowadays, there will be an obligatory 3D spectacular fest with the first 5 minutes in case anyone walked out due to the attention deficit disorder. Let's be honest, as an adult, child actors and comedy villains are never going to really cut it, especially when you have your own kids talking back to you. But compared with most of the fodder put out for young minds today, it's pretty solid stuff. It may not stand much of a rewatch for me, but beats the pants of Barney and the Rainbow Magic Fairies. And while my kids are a bit young for it now, it'll probably be dusted off in a year or three. Though I may not be trying to explain the symbolism behind the teenage girl catching crabs at the docks. Splashy, splashy, happy Dave. What was all that about, by the way? The catching the crab and the dunking of the head?
I don't know.
What bit was this?
Right at the very beginning, Martha Plimpton comes out and she's...
Yeah.
She was apple bobbing for crabs or something.
Yeah, and then she just...
I thought she was just washing her hair.
No, she carries a crab. She pulls a crab out there.
Hmm.
Yeah, that's when the robbery or the escapers came past.
Well, the whole point of that is to see each of them and their, like, it's a bit of
native environment.
Yeah.
So she's pulling crabs.
I just assumed that she was just like this hard case nutter psycho girl type thing.
Which is never explained.
Yeah.
No. Pretty much like Mouth, never been explained.
Yeah.
He's clearly fine. He's got no problems, but he's still a cunt. But anyway, thank you very much, there, Happy Dave Renane, over there in New Zealand town. And, what do you reckon? Well, I guess, obviously he likes it, but all good? No one got anything to say?
No, Dave presents it so eloquently, I think, you know.
He's right where the 80s are a different world, where you have at one moment the baddies trying to put the kid's hand into a blender. That is one bit that jarred me. Not the blender bit, but where you've the baddies, they do want to kill these kids. They're shooting bullets at these kids at one point. Hmm. They're making them walk the plank. But then you also have them making jump ropes as well, and that kind of clashes.
Yeah, but that's going back to my original point.
Mm. I agree with it for that. Yeah, definitely.
One minute they're proper hardcore written villains, and next minute they're comedy Disney villains. And it just make your fucking mind up and stick to it. But anyway, I don't know. Right. Well, thank you very much for that, Dave. And now it's on to the MP3 feedback. And so our first piece of MP3 comes from the Orgs. Pete and I believe Anne-Marie is going to be on this. And they do the Orgcast, which you can find on Geek Planet Online and on iTunes. And it is the Star Trek Next Generation DS9 podcast. And very entertaining is too. So let's hear what they have to say about the Goonies.
Hello!
Hello!
We just watched Goonies.
Yeah, first time ever for me.
And first time in at least 20 years for me. I quite enjoyed it. I realised it wasn't aimed at my age group now.
Mm-hmm.
It was aimed at the age group I was then.
Right. Yeah, I might have liked it when I was a kid. I'm not sure, to be honest. The most annoying feature was definitely the speed at which a lot of the characters spoke, which made them fairly incomprehensible.
But yeah,
that might just be me being old. Well, no, it's not me being old, because our daughter said, "Why are they talking so fast? Have you got it on fast forward?" It's like, no.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's an interesting way of fitting in all your plot exposition, get everybody, all the characters to talk crazily fast.
Yeah. I suppose the modern day equivalent is everybody mumbling.
Yes, it is, rather, yeah. It sort of struck me as being a bit like a sort of US version of the old Children's Film Foundation movies I saw as a kid, which are always vaguely better than doing nothing else, but never that entertaining, you know. Which I guess is how I'd class this film, to be honest. I mean, it's no great... I mean, the baddies are vaguely interesting. It's funny to see Joey Pants with hair.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it's not exactly a film I'm going to be rushing to watch again, it has to be said.
No.
I thought it was going to go sort of take off and go a bit Indiana Jones at one point, but then it didn't, and it just stayed with...
Well, it sort of did. There were a lot of Indiana Jones
aspects. The traps were good,
yes,
but if you narrowed it down to those bits, I mean, to be honest, it wasn't much more than 10 minutes of sort of exciting trap business.
What I didn't get, and I'm sure it's not... I wouldn't have noticed this as a kid, but I did as an adult, right, is they have to be rescued from walking the plank, which would make them go in the water. And then they run away and escape by jumping off the plank and going in the water.
Well, and they got their hands tied or something, because they were worried they were going to drown.
Oh.
I think that's the difference. They're all right to leap in once they've undone their bonds.
Right. Because you can't use your legs to swim at all, can you?
Well, I guess it's probably not so easy to swim if you've got your hands tied together. Meh, really. Big pile of meh.
Oh. Okay. No, I quite liked it.
Uh-huh.
I wouldn't describe it as meh, but I think for me it's like if you were going to give like stars out of five, for me this is kind of like a 3 out of 5. Do you know what I mean? It's not brilliant, but it's not bad.
Yeah, 2.5, definitely.
Oh, okay. You're not...
Slap bang in the middle of meh.
Nah, I'm just the slightly the good side of meh, if that makes sense.
Catch you next time, chaps.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye. And thank you for that. So, there you go.
Mm.
Pete's a bit more on my side. I don't feel quite so alone.
I don't know. I didn't feel the rage from him.
Yeah, I know. But he had the full-on meh, so it wasn't really doing anything for him either, to be honest. Though, I would have preferred... I would have liked a bit more rage, Pete, you know, next time you're feeling a bit meh.
I think the dark parts of this movie might be helping people retain that nostalgia with this movie as well.
Yeah, actually, that's true. I mean, it's that whole thing of... The movie grows up with you, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
It's that thing that everyone wanted from Star Wars. You know, they watched it and it was a kid's film and Empire was a bit dark and then they wanted it a bit more and then they didn't get it and then they grew up and they wanted Phantom Menace to be Empire Strikes Back and dark and grim dark. And then didn't get that either and then
I definitely
it.
Noticed it more now. But like I said, maybe it was just because I missed that first bit every time I saw it. Because I'm frantically trying to switch the video recorder on. But when you could do that.
Yeah. Pressing pause between the adverts.
Between the adverts, yeah. But yeah, I didn't get as much of a disconnect as you did with that, the tone of it. But
okay.
I can definitely see the two different sides of it.
Okay, cool. Well, anyway, thank you very much again, Pete and Anne-Marie. And like I say, if you want to hear more of them, listen to the Org cast on Geek Planet Online and on iTunes. Right, who do we have next? Well, our next piece of feedback is from Pete Hammond. And Pete Hammond has this to say about the Goonies.
Hello, esteemed gentlemen of the Blackdog. This is Pete Hammond leaving feedback for the Goonies. When I first saw the Goonies, I was probably about 10 or 11, way back in the mid-80s. And it was during a period of time when my father, off his own back, was deciding to take me to see any film and every film he possibly could at our local cinema. Saw a whole host of things, and The Goonies was one of them. And I remember at the time thinking, I absolutely loved this film. It was brilliant. I was, you know, target audience, young lad. And it was a, you know, a rip-roaring adventure with frills and spills and all the rest of it. Absolutely loved it. Brilliant film. And then a little while later, when it came out on VHS, saw it again, still loved it, still thought it was absolutely brilliant. And, you know, it was a great little film, absolutely loved it. But then everybody else in my school saw it and picked up on the one issue that I hadn't done in my young state. See, I was a school fat kid, and The Goonies provided all the school bullies with enough ammunition to torment me with for years and years and years. And I had years of having to do the fucking truffle shuffle and getting called Chunk. Any girl that, and this went on for years afterwards, that paid any attention to me, got called Sloth as well, because obviously Sloth loves Chunk. So there was all that sort of shit as well, and it really tarnished my opinion of this film, and I fucking hated it from there on in. Just conjures up all sorts of childhood memories for me, unfortunately. So on this most recent watch, I thought, right, I'm 37 now, I've represented Great Britain in American football, and I had trials for Southwest of England rugby. So, you know, I've come a long way since then, and sat down to watch it with fresh eyes, as it were. And, well, not so fresh eyes, apparently, because I still couldn't get past it. And, yeah, it really, really has been tarnished for me. I know Spielberg didn't direct it, but he did write it, and he's championed with being, you know, this great sort of writer and director of children's films, and family are always at the heart of everything. And, no, unfortunately, on this one, matey, you dropped the ball quite badly and provided school bullies with ammunition to, well, even more ammunition if it were needed, to take the piss out of the fat kids at school. So, no. Big thumbs down for me, unfortunately. Still don't like it, still can't stand it. I think some of the characterisations were lazy. Sean Austin was an irritating little bastard, even though he wasn't bothering hobbits. And no, I just couldn't get past the movie, and I just didn't like it. The other thing as well, I'm sure other people have picked up on this and explained it, and maybe there's another cut, but when, I can't think of the kid's name now, Short Round, when they're rescued at the end, he utters the phrase, and then there was the bit with the octopus. That wasn't in the cut of the film I saw, and it certainly wasn't in the cut of the film I saw when I was a kid, so where's my fucking octopus, you bastard? Ah, fuck it, I don't like this film. Oh, well then, cheers, guys. Keep up the good work. I would, however, recommend a probationary period for young Mr. McManus if he's going to start spouting that kind of crap about alien cubed, or, you know, just pass around whatever it is the hell you're on, boy. All right, guys, cheers.
Thank you very much for that, Pete. And yes, I'm not the only psychologically scarred person in the room. Hooray!
Do you know what? After reading some of Pete's posts on Facebook about his adventures down the gym, I find it very hard imagining anybody picking on him, actually.
Yeah, but, you know, I mean, I'm still a fairly husky fella, but I don't feel like anyone would actually try and pick on me anymore.
No, they wouldn't. No. But anyway, just, you know, Pete being a rugby player and stuff like this, and like, you know.
But it still hurts, Darren. Still hurts. Truffle shuffle cunts. Right. Anyway, thank you very much for that, Pete. I feel your pain. Right. So let's move on swiftly. And we go on to our next piece of MP3 feedback, which is from Murray the Pie Man Christensen. And yes, some MP3 from him this week. And let's hear what he has to say about the Goonies.
Hello, Blackdoggers. Murray the Pie Man here to talk about the Goonies. I do apologise if I ramble or drift off subject. I am just about to go to bed after a fairly long and hefty night shift. But on to the film. Now, I have to make a confession with this. I can't review this film subjectively. That's what I found out. Or objectively, rather. That's what I found out watching it this time round. I just absolutely love it. But even trying to watch it, I'm not absolutely immune to its flaws. I just don't care. Because this was, if I remember, this was one of the first videos I ever rented. It was, you know, a film I saw a lot throughout my sort of early childhood years. And it's just stuck with me as an absolutely sort of key part of my childhood. What was interesting, though, was that my wife actually hadn't seen it when we were going out when we started going out, and I showed it to her, and she really didn't have the love for it. And I think this is it. I think when this film's an integral part of your childhood, you see past or you forgive it all its flaws. I mean, I did notice this time round that some of the actors are a bit shonky. In fact, quite a few of them are. The script just kind of bumbles about. It does just go from A to B to C, but it's very functional. It's not a complex storytelling. And, you know, it's basically a very kiddie adventure, which is nothing wrong with that. I actually think it does it very, very well. But, yes, to see it hailed as this classic of movie making is probably a bit much, if we look at it honestly. That being said, I still absolutely adore it. It's just, and like I say, I think part of that is subjective. It is very much a rose-tinted specs. I think if I had the ability to look at this film objectively, I'd not like it nearly as much. In fact, I might even find it quite dull. But as it is, it kind of drags me right back to being sort of 8 on a drizzly summer holiday, stuck in watching TV. It drizzles a lot on summer holidays in Scotland. And, you know, sort of eating cheese sandwiches or ham sandwiches and overly white bread and eating too much sugar and whatnot. And yeah, just brings me right back to my childhood. And I think without that, it probably doesn't stand up. I'll be interested to see what other people think, what people who maybe didn't grow up with the film thought about it. And, you know, there are things in it. Like, for instance, watching it now, I really like Chunk as a character. I think he was the comedy relief and basically the kind of butt monkey of the film, and you do actually watching it now as a grown-up, I kind of feel sorry for him. I think they're quite harsh on it, the script writers, that is. You know, everything bad happens to him, which is a shame because he's quite a likeable wee character. Meanwhile, a lot of the other ones
aren't so... It's not so much they're not likable, they're just very, very flat. The characters probably aren't that well drawn out. Again, like I say, these are the flaws that I can sort of see with my objective hat on. But none of it spoils my enjoyment of the film. And it's, like I said, for that reason that I think if you don't have the childish attachment, then I think it doesn't come off as well a good a film. I mean, for example, one of the things my wife pointed out was Mikey's constant dropping into sort of motivational speeches, and she was joking at me saying, yes, you can see him in 20 years' time, he'll be sitting there trying to encourage some minimum wage employees, come on, let's go and have the best day at Aldi ever. And that was her, you know, that was her view. She very much didn't, and you know, it was kind of, why is there a water slide in this cave? Who built it? They spent all this time building these sort of easily avoidable traps. You know, she doesn't have the love for it I do, and I think it is through not growing up with it. So, but yes, overall though, I can't help but like it. I think I'm literally almost predisposed to it now. It's been kind of ingrained into my psyche. You know, it's a bit like trying to say, you know, you've got a family pet and it's rubbish, it's old and it smells, but it's the family pet you've had since you were a kid and you will not hear a word said against it, and you will point out that this is the best damn animal in the world, even though it quite clearly is an incontinent, old, bad-tempered cat. So, yes, it's an incontinent, not an incontinent, old, bad-tempered cat, but like I say, I think this film still has a lot of charm to it, but I think a lot of that might be in my own head. So, it's still a very positive film for me, but I will not jump down the throat or try to kill anyone who says they don't like it. In fact, I think I quite understand people who don't like it. It's just, I'm not one of them. So, as always, do keep up the good work. A very belated happy 200th episode. In fact, hey, happy 202, three, happy 200 and something episode. Look at that new milestone that we've just made up. So yeah, keep up the good work, guys, and I'll hope to talk to you again on another occasion. Until then, bye for now.
Right, thank you very much for that, Murray. Yes, well, at least you admit it's the firmly fixed rose-tinted specs, and you know what? Stick with your wife, because she's obviously clear of head and a fine judge of films. Because, yeah, easily avoidable traps. And, yes, Mikey wouldn't be working in Aldi. I think he'd be working in McDonald's. I think he would. Today, you may think that it's just another cheeseburger, but it's not just another cheeseburger, oh no.
It's the one-eyed Willy of cheeseburgers.
It's the one-eyed Willy in a bun.
Oh, probably is.
Wouldn't that be a hot dog then?
I'm going to stick one-eyed Willy between two young buns.
There you go. And then smother them in mustard.
Smother them in mayo. Anyway, thank you again for that, Murray. And yes, hopefully we'll hear more from you soon. And thanks for our belated 202 anniversary. Right. So, two more pieces of feedback to go, and then we'll wrap this all up. But the first one is from our man in Canada, which is Herc. And
woo!
Woo! Go, Herc. And let's hear what he has to say about Goonies.
Hello, Lee, Darren, Jim, and Elton. I know I said I wouldn't, but between watching the trailer on the Facebook page and listening to a song called Taffy Butt, I got hit by a nostalgia and had to watch this again. Just couldn't help myself. Don't get me wrong, I find it pretty fucking hilarious that four grown men have been encouraged to seriously review the Goonies, but still I should probably apologise on behalf of my peers. It's a film that receives really disproportionate praise and should probably be the main example of hype backlash on TV tropes. It's pretty simple, it's just not for adults. I think my generation should have just remembered it fondly and, you know, stopped talking about it when talking to adults. It's pretty much Temple of Doom for kids. Everything that happens is in service of a popcorn-chomping haunted house ride for children, and it operates on just pure Indiana Jones logic. I mean, when Mouth translates the Spanish on the map, it rhymes in English. It's funny, that. So, I don't think we have to go into too much detail with this. As obvious as much of the comedy is, it has its share of funny moments, and it has a couple of heartwarming moments. I mean, it's a good performance from Mikey, because he seems believably heartbroken about being forced to move, and, you know, believably earnest about this being their last chance to save their homes. Also, I really think the score is excellent. It's a good blend of playful and mysterious without getting too twee. Anyway, I see the film's faults. Like, it's formulaic, there's little physical or logical sense, and Corey Feldman is pretty irritating, but I find it really easy to look past that. Obviously, a lot of that is nostalgia, but not all of it. I think because of Mikey, there's a real heart to this, which can let me forgive the broad cartoonishness of it all. Because of him, it doesn't come across as cynical or manipulative, which it easily could do. Although the final scene does veer a bit too close to maudlin. I'm sure you'll find most of the kids irritating, but I'm interested to hear if you agree with that. So, yeah, I really enjoyed watching this again, and I'm sorry that this film is clearly after your time. Just think of it as my generation's Star Wars, in the sense that, you know, we loved it as children, we won't shut the fuck up about it, and we won't stop turning it into something it isn't. And yes, I realise the can of fan-wanky worms I'm opening with that sentence, so preemptively to all my critics, fuck right off. Love and hugs!
Oh, Herc, you tweaky teaser of nostalgia, you. Oh, fucking comparing it to Star Wars, you. No, it's fine. It's I kill you in your face. But, no, it's fine.
He's right about the score as well. That I found that quite jolly.
Really?
Yeah.
I quite like it as well.
Well, yeah. I mean, I just found it kind of Beethoven too. It was a bit. It was just a bit sort of.
No fluffy puppies at all.
It's just, you know, that kind of. We're all having a laugh. Da, 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 da. And now we're going off.
Here's
and
some killers now. La, 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 la.
Here's some killers now. And now we're going on a ride and let's go home. Do, 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 do. Now it's slow.
We're going down the water, going down the water slide.
Exactly. We are up and having an adventure. Now you're in trouble. Dun, 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 dun. Yeah, it was a little bit. Fucking Disney half hour.
Sorry, I'm not allowed to like it. Sorry.
No, you can like it. Yeah. Look. Everyone's allowed to have their opinion. They just have to listen to mine. That's the rule.
That's the price you pay for having your own opinion.
Yes. Yes. See, this is the Faustian pact now, Elton. You're realizing what's going on here.
Mm-hmm.
You see, you're jumping in with your opinion, and that's fine. You just have to listen to mine and not agree with it. You're just wrong. That's it. Everyone's wrong except for me and my ego. Look, it's my podcast, all right? Shut up. Anyway, I'm glad to see no one's evoked shut up, that's why yet. So that's good.
The card is still there.
Is still there.
Everybody gets one.
Let me just say, before we get to Jim, because Jim's the last piece of feedback, let me just say, let's be fair here, I'm not kicking everyone in the balls, right? As has been said before, you know, there is a fair amount of nostalgia to this film, and people get it, and that's fine, you know. And, you know, way back in the midst of time, we watched Blade Runner, and there were people who come up and just go, no, we do not like this, we do not understand it. And then I was kind of a bit like, what, you mean you don't fucking, you know. And so I do understand the nostalgia angle. I do get it. I do appreciate it. And I do appreciate all those people who go, I'm going to tell you how fucking good this is, and if you don't fucking agree with me, you're a fool. So I get that as well. I totally get that. So, no, but in this instance, I don't fucking agree with it. But I understand it.
Okay. That's as far as we'll get with you. I'll take that.
Do you know what? That's as good. That's as much as I'm giving.
I have to admit, this cast has opened my eyes to something I didn't really realise. It's like the reverse nostalgia.
What do you mean?
I have the nostalgia for the movie where I wasn't bullied about this movie.
Mm.
I didn't have that. And so that just totally breezed by me. I saw people getting bullied, you know, at school, being called Chunk and everything, but it never really touched me.
No.
And so now hearing other people's stories and, okay, I never really cottoned onto that. It just didn't appear to me, I suppose. So now I'm seeing it through other people's eyes. I can understand why you haven't got any love for it or you don't want any love for it. That's fine. I think it's good that it's done that to me.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. It's a case of, in some ways, you can have that nostalgia beaten out of you by the fact that it's become a stick to beat you with, you know, and that's a bad thing. And, you know, like I say, go back to the original criticisms, you know, if people were using it as a, moral compass, as a moral guide, and they're sort of like, oh, well, you know, it's okay to bully the fat guy, and the fat guy's all he's going to do is talk about eating, then, you know, don't be surprised when the fat guy in real life turns around and punches you in the mouth or tells you to fuck off or does both. But, you know, don't expect him to suddenly like the film because you did, you know.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, but, you know, as I said, psychological story time is another podcast. So we'll come to that another time. But anyway, so there you go. Right, let's wrap this up then. Let's wrap this up with our traditional final feedback, which is, of course, Mr. Jim, gun running in the Algarve moon.
So then, the Goonies. Well, I have to start with a confession. I'd never actually seen this movie before. I'd seen various bits of it on TV, but never the whole thing from end, as it were, to end. Now, I was well aware of the film when it hit cinemas back in 1985, well enough to know that this was a film with a good pedigree, coming out of the Spielberg stable, and directed by that old reliable hand, Dickie Donner. However, it was equally apparent to me that this really was kids' stuff. And at that age of being 15 or 16, the prospect of watching a lot of younger kids go on an adventure just, well, wasn't appealing to me. And so I gave it a miss. And indeed, I continued to give it a miss right up until now. I'd seen various bits of it on TV, and to be honest, the bits I'd seen hadn't really inspired me to try a full viewing. Now then, I mention this because I know this film is much beloved by many people. However, I suspect that, for many people, they were more of the right age to enjoy this film when it came out. For me, as I say, I was at that sensitive moment in your teenage years where you're really desperately wanting to be adult. I was trying to sneak into 18-rated films, and so children's adventure wasn't exactly high on my list. And to be fair, even when I was younger, I've never really, really taken to films with child heroes. All too often we get horrible stage school brats, and instead of identifying with the characters, I just end up being jealous and resenting them. But now, I'm older, wiser, and I'd like to think mellower, and less blinkered in my viewing. And so, I bunged the disc in the machine and settled down to hopefully enjoy some 80s magic I'd missed out on. Sadly, however, this wasn't the case. I think it was the 25-minute mark where I decided the best course of action really would be to construct a time scoop, extract the child catcher from Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, and send him to the future to track down these kids and take them out of time altogether in a Terminator-style fashion. Because, honestly, Jesus Christ, these lot don't shut up, do they? Oh, my God, what a nightmare. Now, in fairness, the actual plot and script of the movie are all, I think, fine and dandy. We have comedy criminals. We have a spooky-looking monster who turns out to have a heart of gold. We have pirates. There's treasure, there are tunnels, there's excitement, there's peril, and there's a lot of humour. However, unfortunately, where this film utterly falls on its arse, I'm afraid, is the actual kids. Now, I know Mr. Donner is a veteran director, but I heavily suspect that very soon he realised he couldn't control this cast in the slightest. I mean, I was seriously considering turning on the subtitles because I don't understand kid anymore. I can't decipher what lines of dialogue are being just bawled out while all the others are also all bawling out their lines, often all at the same time. I mean, it just kills it stone dead. And the thing is, it doesn't have to be this way. I mean, you have other films that have child leads and they manage just fine to actually get the kids to say their line in an ordinary voice and maybe do some acting, and not just all run around shouting at each other. Now, I know this is very realistic to how kids behave, but it does not make great cinema for anyone over the age of 10. Indeed, for me, it was really bringing out the worst of my Harrison Ford get off my lawn kind of attitudes. Because I could see there was an entertaining and fun movie here, but the constant shouting and the fact that most of the lines are nigh unintelligible because of the shouting completely ruined, well, let's be honest, the entire bloody film, making this an exceedingly tedious watch. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's not the worst film ever, because, you know, Donna's direction is fairly solid, and as I said, the storyline does, I think, have real potential. It's just the trouble is, you can't relate to the characters when you just want to clip them round the ear and scream, "Sit down and shut the fuck up!" I mean, kids might enjoy it, but I even suspect kids today might be, well, a bit put off by, shall we say, the roughness of the performances. I mean, Corey Feldman's pretty good, and he actually stands out. I mean, he can actually deliver his lines. But all the rest, I mean, well, I'm afraid just shouting at the top of your voice just isn't acting. I know that's what Stephen Burkoff and Brian Blessed does, but chaps, you're spotty little brats. You can't get away with this shit. And besides, you're giving me a headache. Now get to bed! Actually, thinking about it, I really think that this is one of those films that would actually benefit from a remake. Now, I know many people will consider that heresy, but seriously, come on. This film would work a lot better with a more talented cast. I mean, even contemporary films of its time did a far better job of it. I mean, I think the big mistake Dickie Don had made was not getting the rest of the cast of Stand By Me when he got Corey Feldman. Because this lot, I'm afraid, well, I'm afraid it is just a film full of short rounds. And the constant running around shouting left me feeling short-changed and very short of temper.
Thank you very much for that, Jim.
Didi.
So, he's currently sitting on his lawn. Get off my lawn! I want my family back. My leg is broken. The Millennium Falcon's fallen on it. Yeah, okay. I'm down with that. I don't agree with the Corey Feldman being good, but, you know, each to their own.
Well, he's a good actor. You don't have to like the character.
Nah, that's fair enough. He made me hate the character, so maybe that's good acting.
Yeah, exactly.
But anyway, yes,
he's right about him. The shouting as well.
Yeah,
I found that almost intolerable.
Yeah, I mean that was one of those things. But then I just took that as an '80s thing because Back to the Future, which came out either the year before or the year after, because they have to get back to 1985. In fact, I think it was this year.
Yeah, same year.
Seemed to revolve around sort of mainly going, Marty, if I shout really loudly, you won't understand what I'm talking about. Get in the car and go to the future, kind of thing. So, yeah, maybe it was just a thing during that era.
Maybe everyone was deaf in the 80s.
What? And then, of course, then you got things like Lost Boys, same thing, shouting over the top of bridges and
railways.
Trains.
Yeah.
And yes. Anyway, lots of shouting. But anyway, thank you very much for that, Jim, and we'll look forward to speaking to you next week in person. And speaking of next week, that's the end of the feedback, wrapped all up in a nice, neat bow, and we must move on to our next film. That, by the way, thank you very much to everyone who sent in feedback this week and everyone who's got as far as this part of the podcast. So, next week's film. Now, next week's film, I'm pretty sure, for most people, is going to be a Mystery Monocle. I've never seen it. I've heard of it, but I've never seen it. I have no idea what it's about. It's a film called Detention. A film that came out in 2011 and did gangbusters at South by Southwest film festivals. But really, I don't think it ever really got it over here. I mean, I think it came out on DVD over here, or it came out on limited release over here, but I know next to absolutely fuck all about it. And Darren, what about you?
I know absolutely nothing about it. I've seen probably the first 5 minutes of this film.
Yep.
It's bonkers.
Right. Okay. That's cool. That's all you mean. Yeah. Yeah, don't spoil it, because I think
I'm not going to say a word about it, because it's best to go in completely cold with this film, but it is... When I say bonkers, I don't mean it in a bad way either. It's bonkers in a very good way.
Okay.
But that's the impression I got from it. So yeah, cool. Just go in cold. Don't look at any trailers. Just watch it.
Okay. Elton, I guess you haven't seen it?
I haven't seen it. Surprise, surprise. Never heard of it. Don't know anything about it. Haven't seen any trailers. Haven't seen any posters, covers, or anything like that. So
cool.
This is a mystery monocle for me.
A true mystery monocle all round. So
yeah.
Before we could have a mystery monocle all round, we did have to have someone who did know something about the film, at least. And so next week, we'll be joined by guest co-host Dave Deans, who suggested the film in the first place. And, yes. And so he'll be joining us on the cast along with Jim. And have you seen it, Laura?
Nope.
Never no idea. Heard of it. Not a thing. Right, okay. Nope. So this is... I think this is 99.999% of us all going in cold on this one.
I'm very excited.
That's very good. This is a true mystery monocle, I think.
Mm.
So, yes, looking forward to it. So, next week, detention for everyone. So, yes. So, if you somehow manage to get a copy of it, I'm sure Mr. Chris Johnson, upon hearing this, has already leapt into action and... YouTube is being scoured as we speak. But yes, if you have seen it or you are seeing it or you are somehow managing to get a copy of it, do let us know what you think about it by sending in feedback to us at blackdog@geekplanetonline.com or writing on the Facebook group, which is facebook.com/groups/theblackdogpodcast. And it just leaves me to say thank you to everyone for taking part this week tonight. Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Darren.
Thank you.
Thank you, Elton.
Thank you very much.
Yes. Was it more or less painful than last week?
This was less painful. I think I just resigned myself to, okay, everyone else has an opinion.
There you go. So begins the erosion of your humanity. Right. So don't worry, dude. We'll have you all just saying yes by the end of the year. Just saying nothing else. Yes, that's it. Right. So, thank you, everyone. And thanks for listening. And we'll see you all next week for detention. Ha ha ha. That's not going to get old very quickly, is it? Until then, see you soon. Take care. Tutti bye.
Bye.
Oh, very harmonic.